are you?
My name's Bond. James Bond.
Bond. James Bond.
Bond, what do you think you're doing?
Keeping the British end up, sir.
Welcome to James Bond Radio. News, reviews, and discussion of all things 007.
Pussy. As you can see, I have no problem with female authority.
Oh, pipe down, 007.
Do you expect me to talk?
No, Mr. Bond, I expect you to die.
Hello and welcome to episode 30 of James Bond Radio. My name's Tom Sears and I'm joined by my good buddy Baron Samedi. Say hello, Baron Samedi.
Hello.
Now,
that's enough.
This is as far as it's going to go. For those of you who are listening and not watching on YouTube, Chris had his Baron Samedi mask on there to get into the spirit of today's episode, which is our review of Live and Let Die. Are you excited, Chris?
I'm so excited. Like, Live and Let Die, it's just getting into the Roger era. I just got a huge buzz, you know, and we saw, you know, a couple of things recently which just got me excited about watching the film, and yeah, it was lovely. Apologies about the mask, by the way. My housemate does really good makeup, and I was hoping to get a Baron Samedi face on the go. Unfortunately, she's off on a date, so I had to use another mask instead.
Well, I hope the date was worth it. I hope it goes well.
Yeah. I'll let her know that you said so.
There we go. So how have you been? Did you have a good Christmas?
I did, yeah. I did love it. Quite a quiet Christmas, actually, like with family and everything, but really, really nice. I went over to Ireland to see family over there, so that was cool. And then New Year's, I had a really, really cool New Year's back here with friends, and really interesting and very good New Year.
Very nice.
How about you?
Mine was great. I spent New Year's in New York, which is great because my missus's brother lives there. And excellent. As some of our listeners will know, I did a little bit of location spotting on New Year's Day, and found the occult voodoo shop from Live and Let Die, which was very exciting. It looks almost identical as it did back in the day. So that's how I spent my New Year's with my long-suffering missus trailing behind me doing some location spotting, which was good and appropriate for today's episode.
Yeah, too right. Now, did you actually go into the shop? Did you see? Obviously, it's not the occult shop, but what is it selling at the moment?
Do you know what? I couldn't quite work it out. It was a shop called Essie. And looking through, like, it was, you know, like those weird boutique shops that don't really seem to do it. Like, it's just, it looks really empty in there. It just looked like that. Yeah. So I didn't really look into what it does, but inside looks way different to what it was on the movie. So obviously that was on the set. So, it doesn't look like it inside.
So you didn't go in asking for like a skull or a snake or anything like that.
I had to get my snake wrapped lengthwise.
Yeah, exactly.
No, sadly not. But there you go. But it was all good fun. The Boxing Day quiz seems to have been a big success. We got a lot of listens to that one, and we got the highest score from one of our listeners so far was by Mr. David Diabolik, who got 89 out of 100, which ranks him as M, which is way higher than you and I did.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah. I mean, his knowledge is off the chart. So I was going to say we might have to make it harder, but I don't know if we can, because that was pretty hardcore.
Yeah, it was pretty tough.
Yeah, so well done. Excellent stuff.
Well done, David. So I don't know if there's been anybody that scored higher than that. Obviously, we're relying on your honesty. but let us know if you got any higher. If we've got any hundreds out of a hundreds, then we definitely want to hear from you. So get in touch if you scored that high. Before we crack on, as always, come and join us on Facebook. So just put James Bond Radio into the search. That community is growing nicely. Loads of chit chat every day. I feel like if there's one place to add us, it would be to add us on Facebook, because that's where most of the action happens. Also, you can come and add us on Twitter, which is at James Bond Radio. Or you can come and leave comments on the website itself, jamesbondradio.com, under any of our posts. And as always, which is really helpful for us, if you can come to iTunes, our iTunes page, and leave us a nice glowing 5-star review, that really helps us to grow the audience and kind of rank higher on iTunes and all that kind of stuff. And also, if you're interested in doing a guest blog on the website, get in touch as well. If you've got anything interesting you want to chat about in a blog post on James Bond Radio, then be sure to get in touch, and hopefully we'll get some new articles on the website, which is all good.
And also, anyone that's didn't get around to doing the first quiz, we've got our sort of original Ultimate James Bond quiz on there as well. So if you haven't had that, then feel free to log on and give it a go.
Indeed, yeah. You can. We recorded that last February, I think. There's a bonus episode that's not available on iTunes or anywhere else. If you just come to jamesbondradio.com and put your email in the box, you can take the ultimate quiz, which is another 100 questions. So if you've got your a boner for Bond quizzes after the Christmas one, then there's more for you.
I think there might even be one at Easter. If you know, I think that it's something we're going to have to do, is like a special event. Christmas.
Yeah, absolutely.
Easter, you know.
Holiday time quizzage. I like it. now, something I've spotted, right? I was just combing through. We had a little technical hitch with our Spectre episode on the YouTube version. So I had to kind of do a little bit of re-uploading. And I just listened to the end when we pasted in loads of the audio interviews with the cast members from the Spectre launch. And there's something Ralph Fiennes said that I didn't spot first time around. And it was completely by luck that I landed on that spot. And somebody was asking him about, you know, following on from Judi Dench's M and, like, you know, how he felt about that and all that kind of stuff. And he says, she still haunts this movie in a way you'll find out.
Ooh. So how did we not pick that up before?
I don't know how we missed that, but there it is. So again, you know, we're not talking spoilers here. We're just speculating at this point. So one of our listeners had the theory about the bulldog.
So, yeah, that's right.
So maybe there is some truth in that.
Yeah, I think it's a really good sort of theory, because, you know, we know it's going to be part of the movie. It's on the poster. The way it's been glued back together, there's got to be something inside it that has to be.
Yeah.
And if it's a last mission from Judi Dench, that'd just be so cool. I think it'd be awesome.
That'd be a nice little touch. So she haunts the movie in some way. So I don't know whether she's going to come back like Obi-Wan in ghost form and haunt Bond in his apartment.
Like,
I don't know.
Or like Baron Samedi, Bond will be getting it on. And then suddenly M will like rise up from the bedroom floor and like, yeah.
That would be a shocking thought, wouldn't it? That would put you off your performance. Good God.
Yeah, just a little bit.
007, what the hell do you think you're doing? Anyway, so speaking of which, what's the Bond 24 news this week then, Chris? Or should I say the Spectre news?
The Spectre news now, yeah. So we've got a fair bit. We're still no inkling on the theme song, which is something I thought we might have had a bit more of, you know, a few more clues or a few more rumours or a few more hints. But I'm not sure when exactly we're going to know. I'm assuming they're not going to leave it until, you know, because they like to play the song, don't they, before the film itself, or at least a couple of months or so. I know we've got a while to go, but
yeah,
I think by Easter, I reckon we'll definitely know.
I reckon if I remember correctly, the whole Skyfall song, it came out relatively late, I think. I think it was only a few months before. So I don't know. I reckon if we don't hear by Easter, I think we'll have something by the summer, I would have thought. Maybe like August time, something like that, July and August. But I guess they'll keep that under wraps until, you know, a lot closer to the movie, I guess.
Yeah. So on to sort of actual news, which there is. So Christoph Waltz, he's been in touch with, not with me personally.
But, I was going to say, why didn't you give me a call? Fuck.
But no, he's just sort of said a couple more lines about Spectre and stuff like this. So I just, basically he admitted. Now, again, this isn't going into spoiler area because it has kind of been said before.
Yeah.
So it's kind of heading that way, but it's not a spoiler.
Yeah.
So basically, he admitted that his character, Oberhauser, is a part of an organisation, and he is one of the structure within that organisation. But he did point out that the structure needs no head, i.e. potentially the person who runs the organisation or the company, perhaps they don't need that person in particular. So he does deny that he's an agent of Spectre. So apparently his character is not an agent of Spectre, but he is a part of the organisation and one of the structure. So that was one of the things he said. What do you think? How, you know, does that stir any sort of
interesting thoughts? I tell you what my thoughts are, and we've said it before. Like, I think Eon aren't that good at keeping secrets, and that thing that leaked before even the press conference happened about that they'd announce him as Franz Oberhauser, but he would end up being Blofeld. And, you know, that leaked about Moneypenny as well back in Skyfall. I just don't think they're that good at keeping that kind of secret. So, you know, he's one of the structure. Yeah. That, for me, that could be a code of being number one if he's one of the structure. Do you know what I mean?
I like it. So, that's very good. Yeah. One of the structure. I mean, That, I mean, yeah, that's brilliant. I think, I hope it is, really. I mean, I hope it is. But like you said, it's not Eon, it's not sort of saying Eon's bad at keeping the new. It's just so difficult, isn't it? I mean, no one is going to be able to keep sort of anything secret these days, particularly when it's something as big as Bond. But
yeah.
So that was kind of interesting. He's one of the structure, and that's kind of what we have to go on. Again, if he's not an agent of Spectre, the head of the organisation wouldn't be an agent because he'd run it.
So yeah. Again,
maybe. You never know. But there's a couple of other things that he said. He objects to the label villain for its single-dimensional connotations. So he said historically 007 has faced sort of some of these villains where they're quite, you know, stereotypical and one-directional. But apparently with his character, we'll have to wait and see if that's the case. But I'm assuming there's quite a few twists and turns, and you know.
Yeah.
It's not your your stereotypical sort of character, should we say. So he did actually mention a bit about the leaks and the hackers with everything that happened in Sony. And he called those involved pathetic and notes that he understands that leak was not the final draft. So there's been a lot of changes since that whatever script was leaked has leaked. Of it, I mean, even during filming, there's script rewrites throughout.
Yeah.
Okay, not major ones, but you will generally have script rewrites. But, you know, if that wasn't the final draft, I'm sure there's been a few changes since then. So, yeah, that was sort of a bit of interesting news from Christoph there.
Absolutely.
And then the only other news, again, it's not really big news, it's just the fact that they started location filming in Austria. We mentioned before that they were sort of setting up and prepping for it before Christmas. Mm-hmm. And so we know that Daniel Craig and Monica Bellucci were filming there and that they began filming on the 5th of January. So
very nice. So it's back underway after the Christmas break, filming over there in the cold in Austria. Now, I tell you something I've noticed. I've looked at a lot of those kind of like press photos with of Daniel, like on the first day of shooting they took, and you know, there he is stood next to Rory Kinnear and all that kind of stuff. He looks a lot more cheerful these days than he used to. Yeah. Do you remember, like, in pretty much every non-official photo, he always looks a bit grumpy, doesn't he? Whereas now, and I've seen it as well, like in some of the, there's some photos floating around of him in Austria, and you know, loads of fans around him taking selfies with him and all that kind of stuff. And you know what? He's actually half smiling in some of those photos, Chris. I've noticed.
Wow.
You might call it a
maybe
smirk. You might call it
snaps.
Maybe, but he's kind of, you know, there was those pictures of him giving the finger to the press and all that, all good natured with the smile on his face. He's smiling in photos with fans, which is something I've never seen before. So I don't think any of us have ever seen him smile in a photo with fans before. So I don't know what's going on there. I don't know whether he's feeling extra excited about Spectre or he's just in a good mood. I don't know.
I think he's in a happy place. I think he knows what to expect with this film because Sam's back. They're obviously really good mates. They obviously enjoyed working together on Skyfall a lot. You know, that's a director brings so much to a film. And every director's got their own style, their own way of filmmaking, you know. Daniel is obviously extremely happy and extremely keen with how Sam works. A lot of the actors have said that he's brilliant with them. And I think it's a happy set. I think that's what it is. I think perhaps other ones have been a bit... Maybe they're having little jokes on set. Perhaps sometimes with a film that's so big, you might get someone that's so sort of... in the zone in terms of, right, we've got to get this thing done, that they're not relaxing. And I guess with Sam, maybe he allows that to happen or together they get that to happen. So that's kind of what I'd
imagine. Interesting, isn't it? Because we've heard the stories about how, like, a film like Thunderball was a very happy set, for example, and they all felt that they were making a big hit and something special during the filming of that. And then we've all heard that You Only Live Twice was a miserable set and everyone was unhappy and loads of problems and stuff. So maybe you're right. Maybe they've kind of, you know, they know what to expect more with Sam this time. They've had a lot of time to kind of prepare and all that kind of stuff. So maybe that's it. But it's good to see. It's good to see a smile on his face.
Yeah, it's good to see. We'll have to get a three-way photo with him.
Damn right. Daniel in the middle in a James Bond radio sandwich.
Yeah. We'll have to see how big his smile is then.
Yeah.
Not as big as ours.
Yeah. There we go. So we've had some voicemails from our listeners over the last couple of weeks, which is very nice. The first one we got is a message from Ron from Coventry, which we'll play for you now.
Hi there, Tom and Chris. This is Ron from Coventry here in the UK. I'd like to say thanks for the podcasts, which I absolutely love. I'm working my way through each one of them in turn. Also, I've just watched the YouTube clip of your trip to Scaramanga Island, Tom. Thanks for uploading this. It was really interesting. I doubt I'll ever get the chance to go out there for myself, so it was absolutely great to have a look around courtesy of your video. So anyway, cheers, guys. Thanks a lot. Bye.
Okay, thanks for that message, Ron. It's always good to hear some positive vibes from the listeners, and I hope you make it to James Bond Island someday. I feel like you and I should go back together at some point, Chris. It would be a good excuse to go back to that part of the world. But thanks for that, Ron. Good to hear that you're enjoying the show. Now, next up, we've got an appropriate message for today's episode, which is from Jed Jong, who's from Singapore. And he's got an intriguing question that had never crossed my mind before. So let's have a little listen to that.
Hi, this is Jed from Singapore. I've become a really big fan of the podcast and have been on something of a Bond kick after the Spectre announcement. I wanted to ask, in the Live and Let Die theme song performed by Paul McCartney and Wings, there's a line, "You gotta give the other fella hell." Do you think this is a reference to the infamous line as said by George Lazenby's Bond in On Her Majesty's Secret Service, "This never happened to the other fella"? Thanks, and by the way, I really enjoy this function of being able to send in voicemails and hope to be able to do more for future episodes. Thank you so much.
So what do you reckon about that, Chris? I think that's an intriguing question that had never crossed my mind before. What do you think?
Yeah, same here. Like, I normally think about some strange stuff when it comes to Bond and pretty out there sort of ideas, but no, I'd never thought of that before. It certainly could be. I guess, obviously, it depends on how much of a fan Paul McCartney is and how much of an anorak, Bond anorak, he was when he came to writing the song. I'd like to think that it kind of fits if you want it to.
Yeah.
You know, so... But yeah, no, it's quite intriguing. What do you think?
Yeah.
Do you think it's...
I don't know, it could be. It's like, you know, if you think about it, you had "This Never Happened to the Other Fellow." It was a new Bond facing up against Connery. And then you've got a new Bond again. So it's kind of like, you know, is it a reference to Roger, you know, like having to, you know, stand up to Connery and start something new? So it's a funny one. It's definitely worth some thought. Let us know on Facebook, Twitter and all the rest of it what you guys think listening at home, because that's a bloody good question, Jed. And I'm glad you asked it.
If it is the case, perhaps we should look at Living Daylights, GoldenEye and Casino and see if there are similar things.
Indeed. But there we go. So I think before we get cracking on with the movie, it's time for a bit of Bond trivia, don't you?
Ooh, a bit of Bond trivia. Sounds good to me. Do you want to go first?
All right, let's do it. Okay, so my question of the day is...
Yes.
In Live and Let Die...
What? In Live and Let Die, yep.
What did Bond and Baines have in common? I rather Bond like Baines. What did they have in common? Okay.
Baines.
Now I'll reveal the answer to that towards the end of today's episode.
But they both like espresso machines?
Maybe they did. I don't know. He doesn't mention that in particular, but they did have something in common. So let's hear your bit of trivia for the day.
Okay, so my bit of trivia is, after the boat chase, when Bond meets Felix by the docks, Felix shows him three cards, tarot cards. I'd like to know, what three cards does Felix show Bond?
Okay, that's a bloody good one. I know one of them for sure, because I was reading up on that. Yes, that's a good question. I should know that. I can see it in my mind's eye. but well done. Okay, so... Right, it's Live and Let Die time. It's a new era for James Bond Radio. Connery's been put to bed. Lazenby's been put to bed. It's time for some Roger. So the next, you know, seven movie reviews we do is going to be all about Roger. That's quite an investment, isn't it?
It's good. Well, it's a new year, new Bond, podcast number 30. You know, it seems like it's the start of a lot of things. And I was actually super excited. It feels like a long time ago we reviewed Diamonds Now, and... quite a lot has happened in between and everything with Christmas and New Year. And I just got the excitement, you know. I was like, yes, we're getting into Roger territory. And if you know, obviously we've been reviewing all the others, but if it's been a little while, you do get the buzz. And there's so much fun to be had with Roger. Yeah. And Live and Let Die is a solid film. It really is. So I was pumped for it.
Well, for me, this is a funny one, because for me, my weakest area of Bond knowledge is the end of the Roger period. So like we've always said about reviewing these movies again, we're kind of going through them with fresh eyes, trying to watch them. I know it's difficult, but as if you hadn't seen them before, trying to perhaps imagine what they were like when they first came out, the context of the time in which they were released and all that kind of stuff. But typically, this is my favourite Roger film. This is my choice for the number one spot. So whether that's going to change as we go through the Roger movies, I don't know. But yeah, I was
That'd
excited.
Be interesting.
To, yeah, so I was excited to watch it again. It's good. It feels like a new page for us,
especially having been in New York as well.
Exactly. Yeah, completely.
And like not long ago, was it last year or the year before, you were in New Orleans?
It was. Yeah, that was. I think that would have been 2011 or maybe 12 when yeah. I was in New Orleans, and I tracked down the lamppost, or the I don't think it's a lamppost, but like the post that he leans against at the beginning just before he gets stabbed in the funeral sequence.
That's awesome.
I got some photos of that, so I'll post that on the Facebook and all that kind of stuff. So
next time you go to New York, you've got to find, your mission is to find the other filet of soul. So you've found the one in New Orleans, yeah. You found the old cult voodoo shop, so you've got to find the other filet of soul from New York.
Well, do you know what? I thought about going there, because I did find the address, but the building just looked way different, and it's kind of like,
really?
It just doesn't look anything like it, whereas occult really did. But apparently, well, loads of those New York locations just are completely redeveloped now. Like that sequence in the alleyway, like the dirty alleyway where they lead him out and he fights them and stuff, that whole area has been redeveloped, so that alleyway doesn't even exist anymore. Which is,
I was going to say, you can't imagine a load of rubble just being left for like,
somewhere like Manhattan as well.
Years.
It's always on a move, but there we go. So let's get cracking then. So we've got the pre-title sequence, or we've got the gun barrel first, I suppose, before we even talk about the pre-title sequence.
Yeah.
So how do you feel about Roger's gun barrel?
I've got two things to say. I think the music is awesome. I love it. I think it's fresh. It's different. It gives you, you know, a bit of a kickstart sort of thing. I really liked it. His actual gun sort of shot. Now, again, it's completely different to Connery. It's completely different to Bob Simmons, which we had before. Now, with this one, he brings his arm around, his right arm, and his left arm kind of crosses over at the elbow. But when he fires, it does, I must admit, it does look like the shot is kind of not going towards the screen. When you see the blank go, it almost looks as if it's going slightly to the right of the screen as you're looking at Bond.
Oh, really? Interesting.
Yeah, only just, if you saw it in high def, maybe you could see it even clearer, I'm not sure. But that's kind of what I find. But I still think that stance is good. Those legs are a lot more solid, better than Connery's wobbly leg. It's a good gun barrel, I think.
I would describe it as a very relaxed gun barrel. Like Connery does a sort of a turn and a jump, George does a real turn and a jump and drop to the knee, and they're very animated. Whereas Roger seems to just stroll and sort of just turn at his leisure and shoot, you know, when he's ready. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Which is very Roger-like anyway.
I suppose it is, yeah. And he's the only Bond to use a two-handed grip as well, isn't he? So that's a unique thing. But yeah, I suppose one of the things we need to sort of discuss a little bit is how, when we talked about Majesties, and it's like there was some conscious efforts to mix up the soundtrack and all that kind of stuff to make it, you know, new but still familiar. It wasn't like a complete departure, but there was definitely new elements. And I feel like the worth mentioning is the fact that we don't have John Barry this time. We've got
first
time. We've got George Martin, who you would know as the producer of all the Beatles tunes, which is probably where the link to McCartney came from. But so we've got this whole kind of new 70s funk sound, which I love.
I love the funk.
Yeah, it's brilliant. So straight away we've got this kind of, you know, we've got a new Bond, we've got a new sound, and this kind of new gun barrel approach, which is great, which is kind of somewhat odd in the sense that you don't actually see Bond in the pre-title sequence, do you?
No, so again, this is another first. I think that's a really brave move because, you know, up until, I know obviously Dr. No didn't really have one, but from Russia with Love, it's someone pretending to be Bond, but you still see Bond. And like having a pre-titles without Bond, that's brave. Mm. I think that's really sort of, you know, the audience are expecting to see him on a mission and you don't get that.
Yeah.
But what you do get is a really intriguing sort of original, scary, just like memorable, really, really memorable pre-titles, I think. Just because you've got the three deaths, they're completely different. It's setting something up as well. And I really like it, actually. I remember at one point I did sort of think, oh, Bond's not in it. But now I really, really like the pre-titles, just because it is so different.
Yeah, well, that's it, isn't it? There's, I noticed that there's a lot of jumping around in this pre-title sequence, isn't it? It's basically covering the death of the three agents, which is obviously Bond's mission this time, to investigate those three. You've got the dude, Dawes, in the United Nations with that weird headphone death.
I think it's like, I quite like it. It's like a sonic, I don't know, eardrum blast or something, isn't it? But I love, this is something which I might sort of allude to throughout the podcast. But one thing that I noticed, do you remember one of our listeners mentioned about Majesties and the colour purple being throughout Majesties? Well, with Live and Let Die, the colour is clearly red. You see so much red in this film, like in terms of uniforms, in terms of sets, in terms of everything. And a lot of it is to signify sort of danger. And straight away, you get that with this red cord, you know, these nice white cords, and then the red one goes in. Now, here's an intriguing question. You see the hand. Who do you think murdered Dawes?
Well, that is a good question, right? And I think, like, When I watched that, I thought it would be Teehee, but you see both hands. There's no claws involved.
No.
But the left hand has like a leather sort of bracelet on, like a leather sort of tied, like bracelet type thing.
Okay.
And I tried to keep my eye out for one of the hoodlums to have that bracelet, and I didn't spot them. So I might have missed that. So it's worth anybody who's going to watch it again. Keep your eye out for a hoodlum with a brown, dark brown leather wrist strap on.
And I don't think it'd be Baron Samedi, because I think someone might notice
him. He might be a little bit noticeable, Baron Samedi, just strolling into the United Nations. Yeah. but no, you're right with the whole red colour. I suppose like the theme of Live and Let Die is death, isn't it? It's like, you know, you've got the skulls during the title sequence, which we'll talk about in a minute, and all that kind of stuff. So it's all about the occult and death. So well spotted, red is through everywhere.
So then we go on to the middle death, which is the spot which you were at a few years ago. So this was Hamilton killed in New Orleans. Now this scene, this little bit, I think is genius. Mm.
This is one of those iconic moments, isn't it? Everyone remembers this scene, don't they? And it is how I want my funeral to be when I finally go. Do you know what I mean? That's how I want it to go down.
What, being picked up with a coffin like that, or you mean just everyone with umbrellas and jiving?
Just having a good time. I don't fancy being stabbed by a little dude in the street, but you know, like that whole kind of party atmosphere, I think is great. Everyone remembers that scene, and it's so cool. And like basically the way I did it, when I watched the movie and saw the number on the door behind him, and then as you see the funeral procession come around the corner, you see the street name. The street sign at the back, so I managed to track down that intersection and went there.
Wow.
And it looks identical, like right down to like the scuff marks on the pole, the number above the door. It is identical. It's amazing.
I'm gonna have to get my ass to New Orleans. Point,
it's well worth a visit. But I'll see if I can dig up those photos and put them on Facebook for everyone to have a look at. So that's Hamilton.
Yeah, and the music in it, I have to just mention, is so good. Like, it's so, I could just play it in my head straight away. It's so easy. Mm. You know, but as soon as obviously, the coffin as well. I think the coffin's amazing.
Yeah.
I think we mentioned that as one of our favourite Bond gadgets at one point. And it is eerie. You imagine as a young kid watching that, seeing this guy being stabbed.
Yeah.
Suddenly this coffin, picking him up. It's like, you know, it does hit you a bit, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And then the music suddenly kicks in and everyone's driving away. But yeah, it's a really good bit. I really like that.
Yeah, I think that's one of, if you had to choose, you know, a top 20 iconic moments in Bond, I think that would definitely rank in that somewhere. Yeah,
I think so.
Yeah,
and that little switchblade assassin dude, it gets away with it, doesn't he?
You never see him again, do you?
No, that's it. He kills Strutter later on, and that's it. So he kills two people, gets away with it.
Yeah,
maybe it was his hand that killed Dawes, and then he travelled over.
Maybe, yeah. Maybe that's solved. But there we go. Yeah. So then we move to San Monique, which is the fictional country in the Caribbean, where we see Baines, who has something in common with Bond, which we'll discover later.
And it's not espresso machines.
No. You've got the kind of the whole voodoo kind of setting. Now, this kind of crops up for me throughout a lot of this movie, which I feel it's a bit Indiana Jonesy. Do you know what I mean?
Oh, I can see that actually now you've said it.
Yeah, like that whole sort of like the whole voodoo ceremony is a bit sort of Temple of Doom. Like we'll talk about the boat chase later on. There's a bit towards the end that reminds me.
But it does predate Indiana Jones.
I know, absolutely.
So it's Bond first.
Well, I mean, at the end of the day, Bond is Indiana Jones's father, literally in terms of the actor who played him. But you know what I mean? I wonder how much they, when they made Indiana Jones, how much they looked at this particular film, because they said that it was like Spielberg's attempt to make his own James Bond, wasn't it?
Yeah, that's right. No, I think it's good, but. The thing about this particular scene, now this is another one with the whole voodoo thing. I just, you know, it's unique, isn't it? The spiritual world, it looks crazy. You know, sometimes with Bond, they'll go to certain places or certain things, and back in the day they might not have seen them, but now with the world that we live in, everyone is pretty much seen everywhere in the world and what have you. But, like, the huge majority of the world's population are still not seeing a voodoo ceremony.
Yeah.
And so it is different. It is strange. And there is that sort of eeriness to it. The crazy atmosphere, the crazy drum beats. You've got Dan Bala with like the snakes. He's obviously he's going to use to sacrifice Baines. And again, as a kid or someone young, you're looking at that and you would get shit scared. You'd be like, look at it.
Yeah.
But in a good way, you know, it's powerful. I think there is the only thing about the pre-titles I'm not that I would have liked if it happened would be when the snake bites Baines. If you just saw a couple of drops of blood just go down his neck, or you know, just something that shows that the teeth are sunk in or whatever. That's all I would have liked, just that, and I think it would have been perfect.
It's funny, isn't it? I mean, again, it's the context of the times, but that sort of snake does look suspiciously rubber, doesn't it, in a lot of those points. But apparently Jeffrey Holder apparently he was really scared of snakes and that was a big problem for him, so I think maybe in some, like, I think in those shots where the snake is literally biting the dude on the neck, I think that's a rubber one. But I think obviously in some of those shots it is a real one, obviously, or at least it looks real. But I think like you say, I think in a lot of those old movies, you know, people get shot and they go, and they put their hand up and then you never see any blood. So I think it's just you know, a context of the time. But there it is. So
overall, though, how would you rate the pre-titles compared to the others that we've seen so far? That would be an interesting one.
Yeah, well, it's a funny one because, like, it's, you, like you say, you don't see Bond. And it's kind of like, if you look at, obviously Dr. No doesn't count, but you look at from Russia, there's that real sort of tense scene where you think Bond has been killed. You've got the amazing pre-title in Goldfinger. You know, you've got the kind of the fight and the jetpack in Thunderball. You've got, you know, all the stuff that happens in You Only Live Twice. You've got an amazing pre-title in Honor Majesty's, but they're all kind of pretty action-packed, aren't they? You know what I mean? So I don't know. I think it's, you know, the Jazz Funeral is awesome. I don't know quite how I'd rate it, to be honest, because it's not like Bond is involved. It's like how could you compare this to Goldfinger, for example?
It's very tricky. I would rate it above Diamonds pre-titles. I know that.
Yeah,
I'd definitely rate it above that. I think Live and Let Die pre-titles and You Only Live Twice pre-titles would probably be on par for me.
Yeah,
and I'd put the rest of them above it.
Yeah.
Just because you've got, I mean, from Russia's, like you said, from Russia, Goldfinger, Thunderball, Honor Majesty's, they are like tip top. They're brilliant. I'd put it above Majesty's and maybe alongside You Only Live Twice, I think.
Cool. Sounds good. So then as Baines dies, poor bastard, we segue into the title theme, which it's got to be said, it's a great song. Like,
it's a corker.
Yeah,
it's so good.
Now, if you're gonna update Bond for the 70s, like a great way to do it is to update the sound of the song and the sound of music. And this is the first rock tune for Bond. You know, if you compare it to you know, your Thunderballs and your Goldfingers, they almost sound like a completely different era, whereas this is like balls to the wall rock and roll, but still kind of orchestral. But it's it's like, you know, I wonder how that would have been received at the time. It must have been like a, wow, this is weird. This doesn't sound like Bond. You know what I mean?
Yeah, no, definitely. I mean, it definitely wouldn't sound like Bond, but in terms of the other music that was in the world at the time, perhaps more of that type of music was around, or at least starting to happen. So, you know, again, it was a brave decision, I think, bringing a whole new sound. And obviously, Barry couldn't do it, but George Martin on board. I think it works. And I think the title song, it's, you know, it's played everywhere even today, isn't it? McCartney goes, it's probably one of his most favoured songs as an audience member. But it's good because you've got the upbeat, bombastic, you know, but you've also got that sort of slight reggae-ish almost bit below. So it's a nice contrast within the song. But it's one that you can't help sort of feel good when you listen to it. It energises you, doesn't it?
Big time. I saw Paul McCartney live once, and I was just waiting for this song throughout the entire set. It was like, you can play all your Beatles ones, get those all out of the way. Let's have some Live and Let Die, please.
Yeah.
And I loved it, man. It was great. But
that would have been awesome. You saw it live.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh, it was probably 4 years ago now I saw him, and that was in the set, so I was very happy. I probably cheered the loudest out of anybody for that song. but there we go. So what do you think of the actual visuals of the title sequence?
So the visuals, I think they were extremely suited to the film. Again, we see a lot of red, a lot of sort of background. The bit I love is when you get sort of this slow zoom in to the girl's face, and it suddenly, with the music, it turns to the skull, and that's brilliant. And then you see flames, and then you see the flames going through the hole in the skull mouth and the eye sockets. And again, I love that. You get a bit where there's the old school sort of, you know, lamps with all the lights, and there's, what do you call them? They're sort of string lamps, you know, with little lights on the end.
Oh, I know what you're saying. Yeah.
I can't remember what they're called, one of those. No. And you get the sort of, the ladies are all painted with little sort of voodoo motifs. So, I mean, I think it was really good. I think for me, it's definitely one of the strongest Roger title sequences.
Yeah, there can be a danger, especially in the Roger period, I must say, of being a bit generic with the visuals. You've got a blue background with a silhouette of a naked lady, which I appreciate, don't get me wrong, you know, holding a gun and sort of dancing around. And that's just, but like, there's some really striking visuals in this one, I think, which is great.
Yeah. I think it's brilliant. So how would you rate that as a title sequence compared to some of the others?
I would say it's right up there for me, right up there. I would say like, oh man, I feel like this rating the title sequences is worthy of an episode in itself.
Yeah, well, we will have to do that. Yeah.
I think Goldfinger's an amazing one. I think Majesty's is an amazing
Majesty's
one.
Majesty's is awesome.
Yeah, I think, I don't know, maybe it's third after those two.
Yeah, I mean, that's high praise. Yeah. That's super high praise. But rightly so, isn't it? Rightly so. Just before we move on the titles, there's one thing that I think we have to mention. There's a good friend of ours who is not 100% keen on the song.
Okay.
Not because it's not a great song, but because there's certain, the way it's worded. And there's one particular line where it says, "The world in which we live in." Now, our mate Gibbers, whenever we speak to him about it, he goes ape, doesn't he?
Yeah.
He goes absolutely ape over that line. And grammatically, perhaps it might not have been correct. Perhaps he could have said "the world in which we're living" as opposed to "live in." But, you know, is it that big a deal? I don't know. What do you think about that?
Well, Giblin is a very special character, isn't he? And we do have to get him on the podcast at some point, because I feel like he is probably the most incendiary, controversial character we could possibly get on here. Do you know what I mean? Like, I know Lazenby kind of divides opinion, but I think Giblin would seriously stoke conversation amongst the listeners. It's for me, I don't even notice it. I don't even care if there's a grammatical error. I think, you know, it's a great song, and who gives a shit? But
brilliant. Exactly.
But Giblin, Giblin would as soon as you even mention Paul McCartney or Live and Let Die, he would just go off on a 30-minute tangent about how that was just completely ruined the entire film.
So how would you rate the song itself over some of the other Bond songs?
I've got to say, this is one of my all-time favourites. I can't rank it right now because I have to give it some serious thought.
We will do it at some point. Yeah. We will do a songs and we'll do a top sequence at some point. Basically, we'll know without a doubt top 10 easy.
Yeah.
I reckon.
Yeah.
Easy.
Well, I mean, top five for me.
Top five, yeah.
Yeah.
And we'll get on and do that. But yeah, cracking song.
Yeah, that's the point. We need to do a theme song episode and a theme sequence visuals episode, don't we, where we go in depth on that. Yeah. But there we go. So moving on then, we see, now this is interesting, right? Because this is the first time we see Roger's Bond, right? Now, Bond is obviously in bed with Miss Caruso, and that's where we see Roger for the first time. Now,
nicely done.
So what I think is it's interesting to like compare that to the previous. Now, there is no beating the first time we see Bond in Dr. No. Hands down, there is no beating that. There's that whole thing that I love so much where you don't see his face for a while.
With George, they did that.
Yeah,
as well.
Same with Majesty's, and you've got all that sort of from behind stuff, which is great. Whereas with Roger, he's just in bed with a beautiful woman. How do you think that compares to the previous? What's come before?
Well, I think it's because of something that you mentioned earlier, in the fact that they were trying to make Roger as different from Sean as they could.
Yeah.
I mean, there are certain things in the film we'll probably get to, but stuff like he never orders a vodka martini. He does mention Bond, James Bond, but that's probably about the only thing that he does Connery-esque like. He smokes cigars instead of cigarettes. And I think this was just another way, another way of making him less Connery-like in terms of the introduction. For me, it means it's less iconic. It's almost like, you know, it's not as iconic, really. But again, for the Roger Moore type Bond, if someone said, where would you think of Roger? You would think, or in bed with the lady, pretty much, wouldn't you?
Completely.
So in a way, it is right. It is definitely right. But it maybe not has got as much of an impact, but I still think it works.
It's funny, isn't it? Like, I think one thing that we need to talk about throughout this whole review is the different approaches to Roger's Bond than they would have had to Sean's. You know, like, you would have thought maybe you would see him in... I would say if you were to choose, like you say, a way to introduce Roger, it would either be sort of smarmy comments in a casino or in bed with a woman. So I think they kind of nailed that on the head. But I think as well, and like we said, like making it as different from Sean as we can is totally in your face in the fact that M comes and knocks on the door of his apartment. There's no M office scene. They're just kind of doing things slightly from a different angle. Like the same scene, obviously. He's got to get his briefing from M, but they're going to do it in a different way. So, you know, that makes me smile. There's Roger. He's in bed with a young lady. Great.
Yeah, no, it's good. I did think in terms of practicality or perhaps logistically, having M turn up at his apartment is a bit weird.
Yeah.
But you forget that because it's a great scene. The Bernard Lee, Roger Moore sort of chemistry is really good.
It's there straight away, isn't it? There's no messing about.
No messing about at all. They're on it. Really, really good. The fact we get to see his apartment for the first time since Dr. No as well.
Yeah.
Obviously, it's completely different now. You've got his bedroom sort of almost raised up as if it's like the place to be. You know, this is like... And you open the door and that's what you see is the bedroom. So it's like, come on over here, ladies. And then it's quite an interesting style as well because you've got almost like the old school... you know, wooden panelling and stuff like that in the sort of living area. And there is a painting on the wall and I couldn't work out if it was like Nelson or Wellington or I'm not sure. But
it's one of those dudes, isn't it? Yeah, it's one of those guys.
But then contradicting the sort of old sort of style, you've then got this through a 70s modern kitchen with this, you know, the black and white sort of circles or whatever. And it does, like in today, you kind of like look at that and go, whoa, that's a bit
gorgeous. Some funky decor, isn't it?
It's a very funky decor. Yeah. And then he's got his, like we mentioned, the espresso maker. So it is interesting to see his apartment. I'd like to see it again in a future Bond.
Do you know what? I hadn't considered that you see Bond's flat in Dr. No. Because for some reason, I just assumed that was a room at the casino, that it was like a hotel room. But of course, it would be his house, wouldn't it? Yeah, of course it would be. Right. Interesting. So, obviously, where Trench is playing golf in his bedroom and all that kind of stuff.
Because she steals one of his shirts.
Yeah, of course.
So what did you think about the whole bit with Miss Caruso, you know, it's almost like a bit fun and games where she comes out, Moneypenny sees her, she hides in the cupboard, you know, M is about to go to get his coat and Moneypenny helps her. For me, this signifies the difference between Connery and Moneypenny and Moore and Moneypenny. This is like almost a brother, sister or a friendship with this Moneypenny and this Bond. She's kind of helping him out with a woman rather than being a sexual flirt ship, which there definitely was with Connery and Moneypenny. So again, perhaps that was another thing that they installed to show the difference between the two, perhaps.
Yeah, I think, like, when you introduce a new Bond, you've got a very important thing that you've got to do, which is you have to define that Bond almost immediately in that first scene. So, like, you know, with Dr. No, there he is, just looking absolutely cool. Like, you know who that dude is within a minute of seeing him on screen. With Lazenby, there's all that fight stuff. You know he's a much more physical, much more hard-edged Bond. Yeah. With Moore, it's all about the naughtiness, isn't it? There he is in bed. Yeah. You've got this girl tippy-toeing around. He's hiding from him. Like, it's all the cheeky naughtiness. There's nothing hard-edged about Roger. It's all the cheekiness. You know, the magnetic watch to undo the zip. You know what you're in for with Roger's Bond from that scene alone. So I feel like they totally defined him in that first scene.
Yeah, no, they did a great job. I mean, you mentioned the watch there. I think that's, in terms of one of the gadgets and one of the watches, that's got to be one of the best.
Yeah.
It's, you know, the only sad thing about Live and Let Die is the fact that Q isn't in it. You know, obviously, M is almost doing Q's lines in this film, yeah, sort of giving him the watch and stuff. And I think Desmond Llewellyn was working on another film, so he couldn't do it, which is a shame. But literally, that's the only time I think we see M and Moneypenny in this film. It's just that little bit at the start, because we don't see them at the end.
That's true. Yeah.
So it is quite a contained piece with just the MI6 crew.
I guess that makes sense, because apparently it was touch and go whether they were going to bring Bernard Lee back for him, because he was quite ill at that point apparently, and they were on the verge of recasting him, but he kind of pulled it together and got in there. So no wonder his scene was pretty short, I guess.
Yeah. And it was quite funny though. I do like the way he delivered the line when Bond sort of uses his watch and gets a spoon, you know, powerful enough to reflect the path of the bullet, and M's like, I'm very tempted to test that theory now.
Yeah.
And it's nice byplay there, and like, yeah, M's putting him in his place.
He seems very grumpy with Bond, doesn't he? He's not happy with him.
No, because he's not really. I remember he mentioned as well something about the Italians were most impressed with the way you handled the Rome affair. And that's kind of a nice little link to Spectre with Bond going to Rome.
Yeah, well, so absolutely. So it's funny, isn't it? Like, there's all these little references to past missions that I would love to know about. I want to know about that time when Bond was with M in Tokyo in From Rush with Love.
Yeah, that's what I want to know more than anyone.
That's the number one. This one, you know, with the Rome affair. What was that, I wonder? Yeah. Interesting.
Yeah.
I feel like this sequence ends with a great line, which is, shit, magnetism, darling.
I mean, and how it was delivered, again, that's pure Roger. It is magic. And the use of the gadget is brilliant. I think, I love it. Great way to end that scene.
Apparently, that scene took 29 takes to get right, because there was a dude who had her zip on a string who's kind of lying on the floor, just kind of pulling it down.
He was underneath there, wasn't he? He was underneath her dress.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's probably why it took 29 takes, because he probably went, done it wrong again.
Yeah, we got to do that again, I'm afraid.
Yeah.
There you go.
That's what I would have done.
There we go. So that's kind of like our introduction to Roger.
Yeah.
I think it was a bang-up job. I loved it.
Yeah, definitely. And what I loved as well is the transfer from this scene to suddenly the plane and the music kicking in. Straight away, you're getting, you know, he's on route to do a mission. You've got the music kicking in, you see the airplane. I love that bit.
Yeah, it's basically a montage, isn't it? It's like you've got the plane, and then you've got the solitaire giving the tarot reading. You see the cards kind of superimposed over that, and she's
that's
telling
really
the
cool
story of him. I think that's cool as well. It's great, because, again, that's like the first time we meet solitaire. It's kind of like hinted at. Of what's gonna come. So I mean, imagine, like, you back in the day, you've seen this film for the first time. It's not like today where there's a million rumors and internet stuff going around.
Yeah.
You'd have maybe seen a short segment on the news or seen a photograph in a newspaper, and that would have been it. The only other thing you'd have had to go on is the poster of the movie when you went into the cinema. So you would have seen all these tarot cards everywhere, and then here it is on the screen, which is
cool. I did like it.
Yeah.
And basically just showing that, you know, the power that she's got. It's just, again, it's different. You're going into a new world here.
Yeah.
You haven't seen this before, but it's going to be a good sort of journey.
Absolutely.
But no, it's cool.
So Bond arrives in New York, and we meet Felix, who I think is probably everyone's favourite Felix Leiter, I would imagine.
He's definitely one of my favourites, David Hedison, because, again, the chemistry, I think himself and Roger were good friends offset. And the chemistry is one of the best Bond Leiter chemistries on the screen, I think. I really do like David Hedison as Felix.
So you've got that sequence in the car where he's in the back, he's been picked up from the airport, he's in the back of the car, and you've got Whisper pulling up alongside with the little dart in the wing mirror and all that kind of stuff. How do you feel about that sequence?
I actually, the build-up to it I really like. He obviously takes a call from Leiter and he's driving along all happy, and then you see this, the Pimpmobile, you just see it pull up and you know something bad is about to go down, you know, something dodgy is about to happen.
Yeah.
And the fact that the car doesn't overtake, it just sort of rides alongside it, and then the driver, Charlie, I think his name is, sort of is, you know, he's aware that something's not quite right here, but obviously he doesn't know what's going to happen. And then you see Whisper sort of aiming the target, again, red dart, red button, it's all about the red, presses it, and like, boom, and then like speeds off. And that bit I love. That bit I think is great. And then the part that follows where Bond is a backseat driver and takes over, I think it's good. It did look a little bit like I'm being a bit sort of, I don't know. But, you know, it did look as if the cars were quite slow and it was quite staged and he was just weaving in and out. But I think that's different. It's because modern day car chases are just so different, aren't they?
Yeah.
So it's nothing against that scene. It's just, you know, in comparison to sort of modern things. But I still think it's quite cool.
One thing I noticed that's quite odd is, you know, when that sequence comes to an end, so you got Bond kind of steering from the back seat, and then there's that part just at the end where he kind of mounts the steps and then he crashes into that the other side of the street.
Dumps truck.
And then that's where it stops. You notice there's no sound effects during that sequence. So it's like as the car mounts the stairs, there's no sound coming from the car whatsoever. And then as it comes over the other side of the steps, there's like a... I don't know whether it's a bin or something like that. It hits the bin and then you hear a sound and then there's a screech of tires and then the bang when it hits the dump truck.
Okay.
And it's really weird. There's just no sound effects whatsoever. So look out for that next time you watch it.
Yeah, I didn't notice that.
That's kind of interesting. But so after that sequence, we've got kind of the CIA eavesdropping on Dr. Kananga, which I think is a kind of a nice little setup. Did you notice the painting of Morgan Freeman on the wall?
Yes, it looked so much like him, didn't it? Yeah, no, it looked just like him. It was. I did actually think that when I was looking at it this time. But no, it's a good scene because I like the way this one plays up Dr. Kananga, you know, as the Prime Minister of the island, and he's really playing up the whole small island that, you know, needs to sort of look after itself and stuff like that. And I like that.
Yeah.
But there's one thing about this scene which I like even more than anything like that.
I think I can guess what it is.
Solitaire, right, and that sort of lingerie dress thing, like, that is one of the nicest Bond girl images in the whole series for me. I think she looks stunning, so hot. Like, so hot.
It must be said, she is one of the most stunning creatures on this planet, let
still
alone
is
Bond
today
movies.
As well.
I know.
Still
oh,
is today.
Gracious,
like, she's super hot today.
Yeah.
It's like, wow.
Yeah, completely.
Yeah. Right, I just wipe off the drool off my mouth.
So again, any female listeners, apologies. Yeah. It's just it's what happens when Bond girls come up. It's just par for the course, I'm afraid. But so like that sequence, it's funny because you're introduced to obviously Kananga. And I suppose it must be mentioned that this whole Kananga angle isn't in the book at all. This is a whole new development. It's just the villain in Live and Let Die, the book, is just Mr. Big. This is a new angle, which is quite interesting.
So it's quite interesting then. Yeah, I like that. And the other thing is, you notice when you watch it, it's like Teehee's in the scene.
Yeah.
And you never see his claw.
No.
Like, you never see his hand. It's all his hook, whatever. It's always filmed, so his arm's just slightly out of shot, which is obviously a good thing. But it's quite interesting to note.
Yeah.
And then they get changed into all their stuff, and there's a little hidden sort of lift.
Do you know what? I love
stuff.
That bit. There they are dressed all conservatively in their suits.
Yeah.
And then the most amazing pimp outfits are brought through and they change in and they've got these massive felt hats on and like leopard skin scarves and shit. Yeah. It's amazing.
And huge heels as well, isn't it? And like everything like that. Yeah. I like that.
I really wish people still dress like that in this day and age, man. Yeah. It would be amazing. But there we go. So as kind of as Bond kind of has kind of tailed them in a taxi, basically, and shows up outside the occult voodoo shop. So he's on their tail. And and obviously I went there the other day, which is very nice.
Yeah. Very good.
And yeah, so kind of how do you feel about this sequence? He goes in there just browsing. He buys the snake. Looks to make sure it's wrapped lengthwise. She goes out the back to gift wrap it, and then he slips out the side door and sees them all pull away in the car, all pimped out. So how do you feel about that? For me, I feel like this is like the first bit of detective work we see.
Yeah.
We see him doing, you know?
Yeah, he's sneaky, isn't he? He is quite sneaky. I like the way when he first comes in, she's like, something in heads? Like, as if she's asking him what he wants and stuff like that. That's quite a cool little thing. And it's nice because you see the skulls on the shelves and stuff like that. But this is the first time where he's, like, using his wit. Obviously, by the time she comes back out again, she'd try and find out where he is. But, you know, he's seen Whisper, hasn't he? He's seen him go down, followed him. He's checking out the wing mirror of the Pimpmobile, isn't he? Trying to, you know, he knows something's happened from that. And then suddenly he hears a lift, boom, goes down. And then I love seeing those massive platform wheels walking past. And then, obviously, the car gets in the other lift and drives off, and then he sort of legs it out. I think it's good, I like it. Again, it's sort of sneaky, like you said.
Yeah, sneaky. We love to see Bond sneaking around, don't we? It's good.
And then he gets into a taxi with probably one of my most favourite taxi driver of all time. Like, this guy rocks. I like this guy.
I love him.
Good, isn't he?
So, moving on, we're at Filet of Soul, the New York branch.
Yeah.
Which is a cool little restaurant, I must say. A cool little bar, I guess.
Cool bar.
All red everywhere, as you pointed out. Like, everywhere in this.
Red waiter jacket, you know, bar top, all the walls and everything.
There it is. Now, there's this, I think, is, again, one of those real kind of memorable moments from this movie. Like, when they sit in the booth. What's had a nasty turn in a booth? And all that stuff. Like, I think that's a great little moment.
Yeah, I like the bit when he goes in and he basically bourbon and water, please. And then guy's like, and he tells him, "Oh, keep it neat." And the waiter just sort of retorts back, "That's extra, man."
Yeah.
And like, I like that. Like, basically, no ice. Yeah. He has to pay more for, obviously, because he's a honky. You got a honky on your deal. but it's cool. I like it. But what I found with Roger, which we see in a lot of later Rogers, and this is obviously the first one, but he tends to ask for information a lot. Like, I just need to get a bit of information. And, like, that's probably his favourite line.
I
know he does
it
quite a few of the other things, And obviously this is the first time that I think we see him do it with a waiter. But the whole idea of the turning booth, I think, is brilliant. And then, you know, he's suddenly there he is in Mr. Big's little sort of secret holdout. But then and that's when we get here for the very first time, his Bond, James Bond, isn't it?
It is. Very first. So, how does this one make you feel? What do you think of his delivery?
I like it. I think it's obviously not as cool or as Connery's or perhaps as charismatic, but it's in the Roger Moore mold, and it's almost a little bit. He's not put, you know, not. It's not that it's bad, but he's not making it a statement, is he? Mm. It's not like Bond, James Bond. It's
more
it's
of a throwaway line,
basically.
Isn't it? This time around,
exactly. But I think that's because he wants to get on with the chatting up the lady, chatting up Solitaire. Mm. I think. But no, I mean, he's definitely not done bad. I remember Roger saying that he always was frightened of coming up and saying, "My name's Bond, James Bond."
Yeah.
And like, that's what he had in his head the whole time that he was filming.
Yeah.
So, I think he delivered it.
That must be quite a daunting moment for any actor, especially their first time out, to have to say that line. Yeah. Like, the amount they must have done that in front of the mirror before they actually shoot it must be intense. But yeah. But there we go. So we're in Mr. Big's hideout. We see Teehee's claw for the first time. He obviously, you know, snaps or breaks the wall through PPK.
Yeah.
Now, do you think it's somewhat odd that Solitaire has 007 printed on the back of her tarot cards?
Yeah. Well, she's prophetic, isn't it? Yeah. She probably had 006, but when Sean Bean didn't turn up, she quickly whipped out the 007.
Yeah, it was lucky it wasn't one of the other 00s on this mission.
Yeah. No, I think it's cool. I think it's nice because that's a little in joke where you wouldn't see it for sort of the first time you watch it, but for the Bond fan, it's kind of cool. And yeah. I know they might think it's taking you out of the film, but no. I think it's really good. I like
yeah.
that
whole it's not
this. And they do look cool.
It's one of those things, isn't it, where you don't see it unless you look for it. Do you know what I mean? It's not some glaring thing that pulls you out of the movie. I just think it's a little funny thing. I don't think they would do that in this day and age, but...
No, perhaps not. Yeah, but I still think it's quite cool. Yeah. And then she asks him to pull out a card, doesn't she? What's the first card he pulls out?
Well, of course he pulls out the lovers, doesn't he? So there it is.
That's the second one.
Is it the second one?
Yeah.
What's the first one?
The first card? When she asks him to find himself. You have found yourself.
Ah, the fool.
Yeah.
Of course.
And I quite like that because it's almost she's putting Bond down. You know, Bond's in her territory now. Solitaire's got the power. She knows he's not going to pull up a good card because she's foreseen it or whatever. Pulls out the fool and the joke's on Bond. And that's nice because you don't want him to be at the top of his game all the time. You know?
Yeah, absolutely.
And maybe pulling out the fool is Roger Moore's version of Bond, you know, playing the humorous.
Absolutely, yeah, completely.
So there we go. But yeah, no, and then obviously he pulls out the lover's card, us, and then you can see on her face, she's like, oh shit.
Oh no, yeah, she didn't foresee that, did you?
Yeah, too right.
Completely. But there we go. So what I find cool about this is like Mr. Big comes out and he doesn't even give Bond a second of his time. It's just like, take this honky out the back and waste him or whatever the line is.
Yeah, yeah. My name's for tombstones, baby.
Names for tombstones, baby. Yeah. and then we get the alleyway scene. Now, this. How do you feel about this sequence? Because you've got the two hoodlums behind him, at gunpoint, walking down to the alley. I imagine they were going to take him deeper into an alleyway, shoot him in the back of the head, and call it a day.
That's the question, isn't it? Because I've just said to him, Mr. Big's just giving them orders, take this honky outside and waste him. So they get outside. They've got a gun on him and they keep your hands up, honky, and they tell him to keep walking. But at one point, one of the hoodlums sort of says, what does he think he is? I'm going to blow his freaking head off. And it's almost like that's a threat, but yet they've been told to do it. So that's what he was going to do anyway. And it is a bit strange that why don't they kill it? You know, why don't they shoot him straight away? But perhaps they were looking for something maybe further away from the filet cell. So it's not associated with that.
Yeah.
And perhaps somewhere even further into the sort of doldrums, as it were, back then. I'm not sure.
Yeah, absolutely. But so we have this little moment where he kind of pulls the stairs down, the fire escape down onto them, and there's a little fight. And then we see Strutter, who kind of we thought is a villain because he was kind of tailing him as well. But that's
an interesting thing that they did, wasn't it? Kind of flipped it then. It's like following a cue ball.
Yeah.
And then obviously.
You just imagine that he's another hoodlum, but he's actually one of the goodies.
But what do you think about this? For me, it does mirror a little bit Lieutenant Hip. Because you know in Man With a Golden Gun, Hip, I'm arresting him under Section 5, whatever, and then he gets Bond and thing.
Sorry to interrupt. Can you please just do your Lieutenant Hip impression for me again?
I don't know if it'd be any good now. You really want me to?
Yeah, I really do. I love it so much.
I got to tell you, their father ran karate school.
Love it. Sorry, you can carry on now.
Okay, that's all right. Anyways, the listeners don't have to listen to that anymore. I apologise. So with the Lieutenant Hip, it's almost like, why didn't he tell Bond where he's taking him and so on? And when Strutter sort of gets in and says, drop it, sort of thing, he could almost just say, hi, my name's Strutter, I'm from the CIA, how are you doing? But it's like, you know, he doesn't. And I guess maybe he's just being cautious because perhaps if Bond sees him with a gun, Bond might shoot him, I'm not sure, but there were hints of, well, why didn't you just sort of tell him? But I don't know, what do you think?
Yeah, it's just a dramatic device, isn't it? In reality, he'd be like, all right, I'm from the CIA, but in this, it's like, oh no, who's got him now? But,
it's
all right. But Yeah, so it's kind of so he gets back in the car, doesn't he? And we hear Felix over the sort of radio intercom type thing. A genuine
Bond
Felix
doesn't
lighter.
Know where he is, does he?
Yeah,
yeah.
Which is nice. Yeah. And then he's coming out of the lighter, isn't he?
Yeah, illuminating. Yeah, no, it's cool. I like that bit. It's a nice little payoff there.
Yeah, completely.
And then after that, where does he jet off to?
We go off to San Monique. So basically the CIA fellows have overheard that Kananga's got his private plane and he's leaving within the hour. So Bond follows him. And I'd forgotten how quickly it moves to San Monique, actually. When I watched the movie again, I felt like there was more in New York before they leave. But it's pretty swift.
Pretty swift, yeah, that's good.
So this is where we kind of see Baron Samedi in full kind of voodoo dance mode, which I really like. And apparently he created his own dance routines in this for the movie, which makes it even better for me, I think.
Yeah, no, it's really cool. And I like the way that he's almost looking at Bond because he does this weird
she's tied up, he's right up in her face like he's motorboating her or something. I love it.
That's good. And then he sort of clocks Bond, and as Bond's walking away, he's doing his dance and his song, but he's almost eyeing him up and sort of pointing at him, sort of saying, you know, I know who you are type thing. And that's quite a cool little scene, I think. And it's good. And then Bond gets inside and the hotel receptionist dude is like, oh yeah, Mrs. Bond is here.
Mrs. Bond? It's funny that, isn't it? Because like I noticed in this section, so he's arrived, he's not expecting a Mrs. Bond, but he's been told Mrs. Bond's checked in.
But an incurable romantic.
Yeah, you would have thought we'd have one of those scenes where he pulls open the door with his gun out and like scans the room, but he doesn't.
Yeah.
Like it cuts back to, you know, all the dance and voodoo-ness, and then in the next one, he's literally running a bath and about to have a shave.
Yeah.
So he's a bit, for me, he's a bit too comfortable with the fact that Mrs. Bond is supposed to have been checked in, because he opens a wardrobe and there's all her clothes hanging up.
That's it.
But I don't know.
And then he's just chilling, isn't he? Yeah. He's probably thinking, great, I'm going to be in the bath. When's she going to turn up?
It is
a bit strange, isn't it? He does seem quite comfortable doing it. I guess he thinks, I don't know. What does he think? It's a strange one. But he obviously, when we have that little cutback to the voodoo bit, that's quite good. You know, you see the guy walking like a spider with his two legs.
He used to freak me out when I was a kid, that dude. Yeah.
It still does a little bit now, I think. But that, I like seeing it because all of that stuff is crazy, and the flamethrowers and stuff. Yeah, like you said, and then cut back to Bond, and then he's having a shave, and you hear the door go, and your champagne, sir.
Excellent.
And all that sort of stuff. Thank you. But now this is interesting, okay, because this is where it gets a bit strange. So we've got a brilliant bit, first of all, with the snake. Now we see the thing go up, the snake comes down the shower pole, he sort of just comes back after sort of paying Whisper or whatever, giving him a tip and taking the champagne. And then it's brilliant, isn't it? I mean, that it's really Bondian. He puts on the aftershave, sees it in the little mirror, and it's right by his ankle as well.
Yeah.
Super, super close. And you know by the colours it looks poisonous and everything like that, and then you know, clever, uses his cigar and the spray and then turns it into a flamethrower. And that bit I love. That bit I think is brilliant. The next bit I do find quite strange. So he comes back in, yeah? He goes to his bed, goes to pick up his gun, and his gun's gone, okay? Then he hears someone, turns out the light, sees his door being opened, uses his cigar to put on what turns out to be Rosie Carver's hand, and then sort of flips her over. She's carrying this other gun, and he's like, Smith & Wesson, you know, 0.48 Smith & Wesson, whatever it is, standard issue CIA. So where has his other gun gone? Was Whisper's intention to come into that apartment to take Bond's gun so he hasn't got it? Or did Rosie come in to take it to then go back out again? I mean,
it's
what
a good
do you
question, isn't
that?
It? Because he runs out of the bathroom, doesn't he? He's trying to find his gun quickly.
Yeah, it's not
just
there.
As a segue, have you noticed how long that cigar is when he's got it between his teeth? It's massive.
It is, do you think it's an innuendo for something?
I don't know, maybe. So
he's his cigars.
He's frantically searching for his gun, doesn't see it, so he uses the cigar as his little weapon. But yeah, good point. I feel like maybe Whisper came in, he plants the top hat with the feather on
it. That's
it,
the little hat as well. Yeah. I was going to say, maybe he did that. But when he first comes in, you do just see the champagne, I think. There's something that I'd have to look at again, because I'd like to think there has to be a reason why he does it. And I'd like to think he either took the gun or put the hat there or did both.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that's probably how it happened.
Yeah. Maybe that was shot and just sort of cut out for pacing or something. But I imagined Whisper took it and planted the hat. Yeah. That's what I took from that. But so here we are meeting Rosie Carver. So one can only describe her as one of the most inept CIA agents ever. She's not the most confident or efficient by any stretch of the imagination.
Well, she was looking after Baines, and we know what happened to him, don't we?
We certainly do, yeah, completely. Yeah. So it's funny, isn't it, how, like, so he's just sort of met her. He's just, you know, she's just pointed a gun at him. He's sort of burnt her with his cigar. And within a few minutes, he's got his hands up to her face and he's just like romancing her and she's all melty and all that kind of stuff. It's like, imagine having that power as a man. Isn't that pretty incredible, isn't it?
Well, I think from her point of view, it's almost like a double bluff, because we got to remember, okay, so now she's working for the CIA, but she's also working for Kananga. How the CIA would pick up an agent like that is beyond me. You know, she's so sort of dodgy, and she's only, you know, this is her second mission, so she's a new agent, so she's with Baines, but prior to Baines she's obviously working for Kananga prior to being with the CIA. That's kind of her boss. So she somehow becomes a CIA agent. You know, things didn't go right for Baines, but obviously that was on the orders of Kananga. So at this hotel she mentions about Felix, obviously telling it her there'll be moments like this with Bond and to use cyanide pills we mentioned in the last one. But she's also for Dr. Kananga, and his mission would be, right, we want you to get close to Bond to find out what he knows and whatever, and just, like, you know, become his confidant and just find out everything.
Yeah.
So, you know, on one way she's saying this about Felix, but she's definitely... No, her mission is to be with Bond. So, but she does seem genuinely shit scared about the little hat, didn't she?
Yeah.
You know, that she isn't a fan of voodoo.
She's pretty superstitious, isn't she? In that sense, but so basically, there's that, and then the next morning, Bond wakes up for a little spot of breakfast, and he gets the little message sent to him, doesn't he? Which I didn't really pick up on this, but basically he gets sent the Queen of Cups in an upside down position at breakfast. So that must have come from solitaire, mustn't it?
Well, no, it definitely was. Now this is the interesting thing, because the only time we've seen them previously is in Mr. Big's headquarters in New York. She sort of, you know, she calls him a fool pretty much. And he pulls out the lover card. Now, she is now helping Bond. So she, you know, by giving him this card, that is her sort of mental decision to help Bond. So straight away, this is the time that she's first gone against Kananga. So, you know, it's not when she slept with him. It started way back here. So it started with her thinking, right, you know, this guy might be able to help me. You know, he's obviously... you know, knows his stuff sort of thing. And this is her way of kind of letting him know and a warning. And I think that sort of sets a tone in terms of, you know, she could never sort of fulfill Kananga's demands ever again, because it started now.
Yeah.
She knows that Bond is the one to help her. And I think that's kind of shows in this scene.
Yeah.
There's just one quick thing I wanted to sort of mention. You know, in the apartment, when Bond checks it out, okay, so he's got this sort of razor that goes around the room looking for bugs, and it, you know, flashes sort of red when he finds it. He shoves a grape in one, pulls out the thing in the other, and that's fine, because straight away you're looking at it, you know what it does.
Does a grape disable a microphone, though? That is the question.
That is it. We'll have to try it. See if it does. Maybe it's a special grape, who knows? But I doubt it. Now, that was one thing. Now, the other quick thing I wanted to mention was his hairbrush. So he's got one of those old school hairbrushes, you know, the hand with all the bristles, sort of thing. Now, what do you know what he's doing with that? You know when he goes to the window, pulls off the antenna and starts tapping it?
So originally he goes, when he first gets in the room, he opens up and he's about to say something, and then he stops himself and thinks, I've got to check the room for bugs. So he scans it out, he scans it over, and then goes to the window and starts doing a bit of Morse code instead.
Yeah. But when you first saw that film, like, did you get that straight away that he was doing Morse code?
I think I probably did, yeah.
did you? Well, yeah. I obviously didn't. I remember thinking him pressing the button and suddenly the water becoming louder. So I thought it was almost like an audio sort of, you know, strict, makes everything, you know, louder. But also we hadn't met Quarrel at that point in the film. So it was like, what is he doing or who is he doing it to? So obviously I know now and I've known for years what it is. But upon first viewing or back when I was a wee one, that did seem a bit strange.
So who is he messaging there? You think it's Quarrel?
So he's messaging Quarrel. Yeah, no, he's definitely Morse code.
How do we know that?
Because I've read it somewhere.
Oh, really?
No, and actually, there is something which I'll mention in a moment on another scene, which kind of alludes to it.
Oh, okay.
In fact, I can mention it now. When they're on the boat, we'll get back to the scene later, but do you remember when on the boat, and he says, Rosie, meet the man who shares my hairbrush, Coral Jr. Now, that could mean the hairbrush is using to Morse code because they're sharing the Morse code. And that's kind of like a subtle little link, and I think that's probably what it means.
Interesting. Yeah. So we'll loop around to that again in a second. So basically the next scene after that is them going to get on on Quarrel's boat, basically Quarrel Jr. Which is interesting because obviously in the original line of books, Live and Let Die came before Dr. No, and Quarrel was in both Live and Let Die and Dr. No. And obviously because the films were made the other way round, Quarrel gets killed, so this has to be Quarrel Jr. So it's the son of Quarrel.
I do like it, though.
Yeah, it's nice. It's a nice little touch. But one thing you realise is that, okay, Rosie goes below decks and she stumbles upon his little secret cupboard with the gun in and all that equipment. So if you think back to the original Quarrel, he was just a simple kind of fisherman and a guide for Bond, whereas this dude is tooled up. So he's obviously a little bit more along the kind of the maybe the CIA or whoever he's working for than his dad was.
Definitely. And I think that I think it's cool, it's kind of updating it a bit. And well, Bond obviously knows his father, so he's known Bond for a while now. Obviously Bond is an agent, and perhaps he's kind of, well, my dad's helped him, how can I sort of help out? So perhaps that was his thinking, becoming sort of an agent.
Yeah.
But there's something I really have to sort of say about that scene before they even get to the boat, which I noticed for the first time upon watching the film. And I wish I had it on Blu-ray because I probably would have seen. But when they first turn up on the dock, the very first shot of you see them in that blue and white striped buggy coming along, there's like a shanty shack sort of on the left with some stalls selling, you know, stuff beneath. Now, on the wall of this scene, there's a sign. Okay. Now, I don't know if you've ever seen this, but the sign reads Dr. Kananga, and I think the next word is reminds.
Okay.
But that's the one that I couldn't really see. Maybe reminds. Then underneath it says, the tourist is our friend, his welfare is our concern. Now, it's really strange. So there's a sign from Dr. Kananga telling people that tourism is good. And I couldn't make out that last word. Maybe reminds isn't right. You'll have to have a look. See if you can find it on Blu-ray. But the fact that there's a sign from Dr. Kananga sort of just shows you, obviously, he kind of owns the island.
He's like he's the Prime Minister, isn't he, of Samonique?
Yeah,
Samonique.
Of course he is.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it was, it's just strange because I've never seen it before. I thought it was quite a cool little thing.
Interesting.
But yeah, there we go.
Very nice. So, when we get on the boat, there's a few kind of puzzling things, I suppose you would say. For example, there's the bit where Rosie says, where can I get changed? And Quarrel just doesn't say anything. Just sort of looks at her.
Why does he not tell her?
I don't know.
Why does he do that? It's strange, isn't it?
It is
just
funny.
Having a perv? Or,
I don't know. I don't know. It's a tricky one. But
and then she goes, me, go change. Where?
Me? As clothes if, off? Where?
It's just like, you know, she's speaking to, I don't know. It is strange that, but he could have just pointed or said something.
Yeah.
But
that's a little bit of an unusual thing. And then obviously she goes below decks. And this is another one of a bit of misdirection that they tried to give us. So she stumbles across his stash of weapons and stuff. And then it cuts to outside. Bond's fishing off the back of the boat. And you see Quarrel behind him and he's like curling a rope and he looks menacing. Yeah. It looks like he's about to like strangle Bond with the rope. And then she comes out, points the gun at him. And then there's that whole exchange there. You might have even killed me if you'd taken off the safety catch. It's not as good as your performance from when you did that quote.
That's a good one.
There we go. So there we go. We get the whole introduction. This is Quarrel Jr., which, you know, Bond fans of the day would have recognised that, you know, Quarrel from Dr. No. And apparently they they bandied about the idea of bringing back Honey Rider in this film as well.
No, I heard that as well. Yeah. That is very strange, isn't it? I mean, they'd obviously, would they have brought back Ursula Andress?
I guess you would have had to on some level, yeah, wouldn't you?
Like, I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, no, because that would have been strange. And then you would have had the whole Rosie, you know, there would have almost been too many female characters, yeah, I think, if they had done that. So it's probably the right decision. But again, it's one of those what ifs. And that would have been a very strange what if, isn't it?
It would have been, but,
I do like the Bond quarrel chemistry. Again, I think it's solid, isn't it? It's good. And it's cool. It's cool a bit. And then they get to the point where he's like, "Quarrel, who in the hell lives up there?" And like, that would be a wicked location to visit if they ever found it. But it's like this big white house on a massive clifftop. And he's like, the Kananga woman, she has the power of the Obia or something like that, doesn't he? So that's quite a cool little bit. I like that.
Yeah, it's nice. And then we kind of, we see Rosie say that they're up in the hills or whatever. So they get
up in the hills down there.
Yeah, like, and then they're in the little wagon and they're driving along. Up in the hills down there, and then he's like, "Well, let's stop, have something to eat, and discuss it." And we don't see it obviously, but Bond has his first outdoor romp, doesn't he?
Yeah. Outdoor and first interracial romp as well.
Absolutely, which was very topical at the time. Apparently, those scenes were cut out in certain countries where, like, that was just like
South Africa,
definitely. Yeah. And I think it was Japan as well that cut out those scenes because it was that sort of thing was just not allowed in those days. Yeah, which was
Bond is at the forefront of, you know,
bringing people together. There you go. Yeah.
Too right.
But it's funny. There's a line in here which when he kind of confronts her about the Queen of Cups card and how she's obviously a fraud and all that kind of stuff. And she's like, "You wouldn't kill me," and he's like, "I certainly wouldn't have killed you before," which is great. Like, I feel like this Bond is perhaps even more of a bastard than Sean's Bond was. Do you know what I mean?
To women, I think he is. I think Sean's Connery was a bit of he was a bit of an abuser sort of thing, abusive, I should say. But he dished out evenly to villains. But I think I was going to say, particularly in this film, Roger's Bond is dodgy with the women. Like, I mean, we'll come to it later, but just briefly mentioning it now, he obviously dupes Solitaire with a stack of cards later into sleeping with her because she's naive and vulnerable. Here, he was like, "Well, I wouldn't kill you before I've shagged you," sort of thing. And so there is that side of him which is a little bit dodgy in a way, I guess. But it's still an interesting delivery, I think.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think it's kind of like it's more of the old school Bond approach and perhaps even more to the Fleming kind of side of things, bizarrely enough, coming from Roger especially.
Roger.
But he seems to be more of a bastard to the women than any of the others, which is interesting. So then we have the little kind of sequence where Rosie runs off and then obviously she gets killed by the kind of scarecrow. Which
is scary, actually.
They are pretty scary, aren't they? Yeah, completely.
Yeah. Do their job, I guess.
Why they didn't shoot Bond as well, I don't know.
The only thing that I can think is that it's loaded with one bullet. It's like the Golden Gun. It's a one bullet shot, and that's all it can handle. And obviously, it was going to be for Bond, but if they say later on that they were afraid that Rosie was going to speak and tell him about him, so they had to kill her.
Yeah.
So I think my logic in that is it's just enough for one shot. Sort of.
Wouldn't it have been more logical just to shoot him rather than her?
But they wouldn't have known that he would have definitely gone that way, perhaps. I don't know.
Yeah.
Then we wouldn't have had the rest of the film.
Yeah, that would have sucked, wouldn't it, in hindsight?
That would have been shit. We wouldn't just have been follow able to have Rosie around for the rest of the film.
Yeah, that wouldn't have worked out anywhere near as well. Yeah.
No, that wouldn't have been good.
So we kind of cut to Kananga having a go at Solitaire. He's not very happy with her, which is odd because he gets the reading from her and previously over the phone. And he's like, "Is it death?" But she's drawn the lovers and she doesn't tell him. Yeah. She lies to him. Yet Rosie still dies. So clearly you could have interpreted that the death card was Rosie's death and not Bond's. But he's pissed off.
Well, that's obviously the excuse.
Yeah, and that's the excuse she gives. But for whatever reason, Kananga doesn't really see it that way. And he's all very much...
It's because he wanted her to say, yeah, it's you know, the death is Bond. That's who he's sort of asking about.
Yeah.
That's purely obviously what's on his mind. And do you know what, again, like we were saying with Roger, Kananga can be a real bastard with women as well.
Yeah.
And like, but the scenes are powerful. I think he gives a really powerful performance.
Yeah.
And like, you know, you wouldn't want to mess with him basically, would you?
No.
You know, Yaphet Kotto, he's a big lad as well, but he's got intensity about him, like a real, you know, power, sort of angry, sort of fury almost.
Yeah.
And yeah, it sort of simmers in this scene and it's unleashed later on in the film. But yeah, I think it's powerful. I think it does a good job.
Now, it's funny, we both broke the same note here, right? Which is basically, there's that whole thing about, Kananga says about Solitaire's mother, and how she would, you know, read for him until she became useless to him because she obviously, you know, lost her virginity.
Got down and dirty.
She got down and dirty. And it's up to him when he decides to take it away from Solitaire himself. Now, who is Solitaire's father then?
Well, this is it. This is it. Well, it obviously is not him.
No, obviously.
It's obviously not Dr. Kananga. So I was thinking, who do you think it could have been? Well, it's in Jamaica.
Because it would assume, like, because he said he obviously took the power away from his mother, from her mother.
No, but he didn't say that.
Oh, did he not?
He said no. He said your mother's lost when your mother lost her power.
Oh, she became
useless to me.
That's right.
So his intention is to obviously keep Solitaire until he either gives in to temptation and she loses her power or, you know, keeps using her. But he said her mother lost her power, so someone else slept with her. So maybe it was like another secret agent from the bygone era.
Yeah.
Who might have done the
That's interesting. Deed, I imagine if Solitaire's mother was basically in Solitaire's place, and then she ended up boning some dude, the likelihood is he would have killed that dude and maybe her as well.
Yeah.
I don't know. Interesting. But maybe that's how he's got Solitaire, is that she had the baby, then he killed her mum and kept her. And
kept the kid. Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Interesting.
Good. Like it. Done. Yeah. Backstory.
So there we go. Filling in the gaps left by Fleming. Yeah. Anyway, so after that, we see Bond hang gliding, which is the first time we've seen him do that. And he's looking pretty chilled out. He's got his cigar on the go, which I think is a nice little touch.
Yeah. And I love the way that his arms are just like, he's still almost just like, just chilling, you know, looking around, tap the ash off while he's like flying up in the air and everything.
Yeah.
I think it's cool. I think it's like suave. It's cool. It's Roger. I love it. First time we see Bond hang gliding. In fact, I think the only times we see him are in two Roger Moores, which is obviously Live and Let Die, and Moonraker when he's on the boat. So Moore likes his hang gliding. But yeah, it's just, he is the epitome of cool, isn't he, when he's
absolutely
doing it. And I like he's got his little button to let Quarrel know when to release the cable and then fly down.
He's got an incredible aim, hasn't he? He's that dude just happens to be peering over the cliff and he just sails down, boots him in the head and takes care of things. But I feel there's a little parallel here with Connery. In the sense that after he lands, he's all dressed in black, but it's actually a reversible jacket that he takes off.
Yeah.
So reversible.
And he whips off the trousers.
And the trousers as well, of course.
Yeah.
So that's kind of like the wetsuit reveal in Goldfinger, isn't it? In some way.
Yeah. Very true. And very cool as well. I do like the fact that he can suddenly just change and, and go in. Yeah, like it. It's cool.
I like it. Now, obviously, we've got the next little scene with Solitaire. With the he's sitting there with her cloak on, which I think is a nice little touch. I think only Moore could have pulled that off.
Yeah, definitely.
And then obviously he's got the.
It is a blasphemy.
Oh, that could have been another quote.
Sorry.
And then he's got the lover's cards, and obviously he deflowers her. By deception, which is another bastardly move, as you pointed out.
Definitely.
But it does make me laugh when they're in bed afterwards and she's all stressing out and she's like, oh, you know, blah, 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 I can't see or whatever. And he just rolls over and he's like, cheer up, darling. There has to be a first time for everyone. Like, he's just he's such a bastard with it.
And like, there's a line that she says something like, the high priestess, wife to the prince, no longer of this world. And you just see Bond sort of going, what the? Is she talking about, just like, what? But no, that's quite good.
That's a nice little
scene. I do
like
that scene. So, yeah, the interesting, obviously, we mentioned previously about the Lover's Lessons. So Lover's Lesson 1, No Secrets, 2, Togetherness Until Death Do Us Part, and 3, Let's Get It On, Sugar. Mm. No, but so basically when we cut to this scene, they've obviously just they've just finished off a wonderful session.
Coital session.
And then afterwards, just before they leave in this scene, she sort of says, is the time for lesson number 3? So, he, you know, he gets a double boning session in this one, this particular scene, you know. So solitaire already, 2 bones to the good.
Mm.
So it would just be interesting to see by the end of the film how many bones we think that is half of a solitaire. Because now I think like
solitaire gets 4 bones.
Yeah, no, I think it's true, because I think like a lot of the other girls, obviously you could say Tracy and Majesty's and perhaps Paris Carver previously, he's been with a lot, but I think solitaire within the film is probably the most he's had, apart from aside Tracy's.
Interesting. So then after that, obviously he kind of whisks her off, and they're sort of they go for a little explore.
No, that was lesson number 4. Follow the scarecrows, and I forgot that.
Yeah, on absolutely. Right. That was one of your quiz questions, wasn't it?
It's not really a lover's lesson, though, is it?
I suppose not.
A tricky one.
So you've got that little scene where they're kind of walking through that weird little graveyard, and weird little Baron Samedi is sitting there with his flute. Yeah. It is a beautiful day. Yes, a beautiful day.
I love that scene. I think it's brilliant.
It's great, isn't it? He's such a weird dude, isn't he?
Yeah, he's great. Like, every scene he's in, you remember, don't you?
Yeah, big time.
Heading for the hill. And all, you know, with a flute.
I love his little flute radio. It's and then there's his little radio in there.
It reminds me a bit of Q, you know, in License to Kill, when he's got the broom. Similar sort of thing.
Very much so, yeah.
Yeah, it's the same with a speaker inside. Very much so. Maybe Q kitted it out, because that's why he wasn't there. He was helping out Assembly or something.
Interesting. Okay. You know what I mean?
But the one thing about this scene, okay, so Solitaire, she's been part of the Kananga sort of crew for a long time. She obviously seen Kananga and so on, Whisper and so on, perhaps. Now, in this scene, it's almost like she hasn't met Baron Samedi before. Like, has she? Because okay, let's put it. There's 2 ways you could look at it. One, if she did know him, she would surely be freaked out, because this guy is like the voodoo god. You know, death follows him around.
Yeah,
she'd be freaked out and like react more than she does. But at the end of the scene, when she's going, she almost waves. But it's almost like you'd wave to someone sitting on a bus stop or something. I don't know. What am I trying to say? You know, someone that you don't know. Mm. It's almost like that. So I think she probably hadn't met him. But I don't know. What do you think about it? Do you think Solitaire knew Baron Samedi prior to that scene or not?
Maybe. I suppose I should imagine he'd be around, wouldn't he? You know,
that's what I would have thought. That's what, because again, he's not in his full makeup.
Yeah,
and obviously when he's on doing the ceremonies, he's all kitted out. But he's got to go through some days where he's just
maybe
like,
it's like a Clark Kent thing where she doesn't recognise him without the makeup and top hat.
Maybe that's the only time she's seen him. Yeah, it's just an interesting thing, because you would have thought she would have known him, but you know, she would have probably have been a bit more scared if she knew that he was, you know, spying them as if she knew that's a good point. Yeah.
So after that, they kind of stumble across the poppy fields, which it should be noted that this is one of those stories where the plot of the villain is completely different to that from the book to the movie. So in the book, like we say, there is no Dr. Kananga, it's just Mr. Big, and it's basically lost pirate treasure and smuggling gold coins. So smuggling gold coins and all that kind of stuff to finance Smursh, I believe. In this case, the plot is growing heroin and giving it away for free throughout America to flood the market, put the competitors out of business, and then follow up with the next batch of heroin, which is going to be super heavy priced and kind of, you know, there you go.
Yeah.
So interesting little plot.
Yeah. And not only is it different to the book, it's also another potential difference to the Connery bonds. Because up until now, pretty much it's been world domination or with Goldfinger, it's greed. But there's, you know, the effects of that would have been...
Yeah.
you know, sort of thing. So there is that sort of power sort of thing. Whereas this, it is a bit different. It is the first time sort of the drugs are the main thing.
Yeah.
And for me, it gives the film a bit more realism. Because I know, obviously, there's some crazy bits, stuff which we'll go on to later, and the voodoo thing and the spiritual side is a bit strange, but yeah. The actual plot is quite realistic.
The thoughts of that, I don't think anyone in their right mind would call Live and Let Die a realistic film, but
no.
What you're saying there is the actual plot of the villain is a real-world potential scenario. So maybe
exactly.
That was a conscious decision, because if you've got this film that's out there and crazy with, you know, supernatural elements, how do you ground it? You give the actual sort of situation they're in a bit of realism based around it, I guess.
Yeah, so well spotted.
So you got basically all these poppy fields hidden under the nets and stuff.
Which I thought was clever and good as well, definitely.
Absolutely. Do you know, that's a technique they used to use during the war as well, actually, with bombing London. I remember there was a story of they put...
You remember?
Like I wasn't there, sadly, no, but I was reading in a book. Where they put some like netting and kind of a disguise from the, so anyone from the air would have seen this building as something that it wasn't, kind of thing. That kind of works. Like you disguise a factory, for example, and make it look like a park, that kind of thing. Yeah. So that kind of does carry across, which is great. Now, Bond's bus driving skills are pretty impressive, aren't they?
Yeah, well, Mr. Roger Moore got, during the sort of development, pre-production for the film, he got a stunt driving test with London Bus Company, and they took him out and gave him a little crash course in how to drive a bus. But yeah, he seems to do all right.
Very nice.
His handbrake turn was pretty nifty, although I don't know if Sir Roger performed that himself.
Yeah. Well, it's funny, isn't it? Because that bus looks so lightweight. And when he does that handbrake turn, how that thing doesn't fall over, I don't know.
It
looks so top-heavy, doesn't it?
Over. Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
But I must say, the San Manikian police force are the most inept police force I have ever seen in the history of any movie in my life. Like, basically, he flips the bus around, and as a result of that bus flipping, every car goes flying off the road in all directions, which is pretty crazy. And motorbikes as well. They all end up, whether it's in the water, in the ditch, wherever, just that one maneuver and they're all game over.
Yeah.
But you notice how there's no music during that sequence. The only time the music hits in is when he's approaching the bridge and you get the street sign saying that it's a low bridge or whatever.
That's true.
So that whole kind of chase sequence ends with, you know, the roof of the bus coming off.
Yeah, that's class. That is class.
Again, that's another one of those memorable moments, isn't it?
Definitely. And I don't know if this is true, but I have heard that Jane Seymour remained in the bus throughout all of the stunts.
I read that too,
She was at the back, and it was like, well, A, she probably wouldn't have been seen even if she was in or she wasn't, and B, they could have used a stunt woman. But she, being 20 or 21 or whatever she was, and a bit naive, or maybe even younger, I can't remember now, like she was actually in the back of the bus the whole time when they did the J-turn and when they hit the bridge and stuff. So that's pretty good, isn't it?
Yeah, that's pretty impressive. They could have easily put a double in there, but good on her for being dedicated. So you kind of got the end of that kind of chase with the kind of the shorn off bus. He drives straight to the dock, and there's Solitaire waiting for him.
Cool.
Sweet mother of pearl. Obviously, Quarrel, not Solitaire, waiting for him. And there we have it. So they have a little getaway on the boat. Now, the one little reference that he says here, again, we're talking about him being a bit of a bastard to the ladies in this. Yeah. He refers to Solitaire as a valuable piece of merchandise during this part. So it's kind of like, you know, he's still a bit of a bastard, isn't he?
He is. Which, with any luck, they'll want back. He is a bit. I am pretty sure we can safely count this as bone number three on the boat. He is. That is a staple of this film, is Bond's sort of nastiness to women, I think.
So there we go. So Bond, basically the link is he wants to go to New Orleans because obviously Henderson? Hamilton?
Hamilton
was murdered there, so he feels there must be a link. And if he takes solitaire there, it's going to draw them out of the woodwork, kind of thing. And that's pretty much what happens immediately. He gets picked up by our good friend taxi driver.
Well, hello, Jim.
What's happening, baby?
That's so good.
I love that dude.
He's amazing. So cool. Now, I've got something to tell you about that, but it'll come at the end of the podcast, which I'm not sure what you'll think of it. But yeah, I've got something to tell you.
All right, I'm excited. I've got bated breath. now, this is one of those little sequences where basically he kind of escapes from them a little bit, jumps in the little plane with Mrs. Bell, which is a lovely little comedy moment, I think. It could have almost been a scene in Diamonds Are Forever, that, I think.
I think very much so, actually. That's a really good point there. It's got the same feel as the moon buggy chasing diamonds. Yeah. Obviously, completely different type of thing, but it's pure comedy. It's like the plane sort of turns, a car flies off into oil drums. The plane turns again, car flies off up a ramp and into a plane. I can't find the brake.
Yeah.
And it's like, yeah, and all that sort of stuff. and obviously you got the comedy value of the plane itself and Mrs. Bell. But I thought it was quite interesting just prior to that where Solitaire like pretends to obviously they've seen her with Bond because they've been following them, but then she's like pretends not to be his friend, don't they? Because they were going to put him in the plane. She's like, oh, what? Was she using that as a distraction to help Bond?
Or I think so.
Her skin?
Yeah.
I think she probably was. Obviously she didn't mean it.
Yeah.
But yeah, so there's that little thing. But I did find, obviously, there's similarities with Pre-Titles of Octopussy, you know, when the plane's coming along and the hangar doors are closing. So that was quite sort of similar. I quite like that. But this is the very first time in the series, I think, where you hear like a profanity, like a pretty coarse swear word,
which is obviously... A holy shit from Mrs. Bell.
Yeah, holy shit, In fact, there are a few different ones in this film, so I think it's the first time they've opened.
There's a lot of hinted swear words from J.W. Pepper later on, isn't there? But don't forget the policeman, the Vegas copper in Diamonds Are Forever, says "you dirty bat," and then they cut. Do you remember?
I think that's probably
the first hinted swear word, but this is the first time we get a fully formed shit in a Bond film, which is great. Anyway, so obviously Bond does a little bit of a plane chase, but on the ground, and gets away, and then we cut to our little friend from the beginning, from the pre-title sequence. Who this time murders Strutter outside of the Filet of Soul.
So this time we don't actually see, he doesn't say anything to him. He just sort of is looking, but we hear the audience are like queued up. You hear the music, you see the procession, and you just see just before all you see is a little assassin dude just sort of smile as if you're about to get it.
Yeah.
That's all you need, isn't it?
Yeah.
And then by the time that Felix and Bond rock up, the funeral procession is underway and they're like, oh, hell of a send-off sort of thing.
Yeah.
And little did they know that Strutter's the one inside the coffin being walked past him, which I think is cool. I do like that.
That is a nice little touch, actually. Yeah. That is good. So this time they enter the New Orleans branch of the Filet of Soul. And
one where you've been.
The place doesn't exist anymore, sadly. It's all like bricked up and different. But
if you were a restaurateur, would you call your restaurant Filet of Soul?
I think I probably would, absolutely. Yeah. And I would make sure that all the booths had little rotating wheels underneath.
Yeah.
And all that
things
kind of
that could drop down, and all the waiters wore red jackets.
Damn right.
Yeah.
So they roll in, and obviously Roger utters the line, "I once had a nasty turn in a booth," and they seat them down the front. Now this is a little bit of a funny thing, isn't it? Because we get the singer come out on stage singing the song "Live and Let Die."
Yeah.
So what do you think about that?
I actually like it. I do. I mean, I know it's a bit strange. It's a bit different. Well, I don't think it's ever been done before. I don't think it's ever been done since, as far as I can remember. Obviously, we've had little themes like the guy in the little sort of cleaning guy in Majesty's Whistling Goldfinger, but in terms of a full-on song. And the fact, obviously, it was a different singer. But it was nice because it was a different take on the song. It worked within the New Orleans setting. I liked it. I thought it was good. And it was interesting as well.
Apparently, because by this point in their relationship, Saltzman and Broccoli were somewhat not best of friends.
Yeah.
And they'd resolved that, like, basically every other film, each one would do. So Live and Let Die was very much Harry Saltzman's film. Yeah. Man with the Golden Gun was very much Broccoli's film. And apparently Harry Saltzman liked Macca's theme tune, but he wanted, like, a female black singer to sing it, like, yeah, in the style of what we hear in this section. And Macca said, you can only have the song if I sing it. It's as simple as that. So he went with it. But it's funny, isn't it? It's kind of like, I don't know, it's kind of like the little Bond theme being played by the Snake Charmer in Octopussy and things like that, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? It's just one of those odd things that make you go, huh. But I don't think it
sort of distracts from the film or makes it bad in any way. I mean, it's a good, BJ Anu, I think, was a singer. And she definitely did a good job. So I think it's good.
Absolutely.
But there is a strange thing, isn't there, that comes after that. So Bond's like, orders his bourbon, and Freeze's like, two Sanzeracs. Where's your sort of, got to enjoy yourself, Bond, sort of thing. And basically, so Felix is told to go to a telephone, and Bond's watching it, and suddenly the floor drops down. Similar sort of idea, ends up in Mr. Big's headquarters in New Orleans. Now, just prior to we go to that scene, the table gets put back, the drinks get put back. Felix Leiter comes back and he's like, where's my friend? And it's like, obviously we don't hear what the waiter says.
Mm.
What excuse could the waiter have used?
Well, you sort of hear a little bit of it, don't you? He's like, he's almost like saying, let me tell you about your friend, like as if Bond had misbehaved and he'd been thrown out or something.
Ah, okay.
Like,
okay.
That's what
I Felix wouldn't have believed at all, would he? But obviously I don't think we then see him until we see him after the boat chase, I think. Yeah. But it's just a bit of a strange one. But then the scene after that is great, isn't it? When Bond, he's down in Mr. Big Sing, the lights go up, and that, I love this sort of setting now. So you've got an all white sort of room, you've got the long table, you've got Bond, gets put in that chair, you've got Teehee standing there again with his red jacket, Mr. Big with his red shirt and his white suit. I love that white suit, by the way, and then like red painting behind him. But the setting is good. The setting is really good. And obviously Solitaire's sitting there, and they get the strange cuffs sort of thing that go over his arm.
Yeah.
What do you think of those? I think they look quite cool, but they do look as if there is enough of a gap that he might have been able
to. It does, doesn't it? It's not the most secure of devices, I don't think, but I guess it kind of serves its purpose. But again, in a kind of parallel with the book, like that scene with Teehee in the book, he actually does break his finger. So there's that kind of alternate thing going on as well with the film. But what I like is the whole the reveal of Mr. Big becoming Kananga. Now, that whole thing, when you look at Mr. Big, you can kind of see that that's makeup, can't you? But it's not...
You can tell it's not quite right, but I've seen a lot... I mean, it's not bad by any means.
That's what I was going to say. It's like you could imagine it being a whole lot worse back in those days, can you? But you can tell there's something weird about his face, can't you? But it's not blatantly obvious what's going on.
But, it's again, for us and for pretty much every other Bond fan that's seen it, you'll know what's coming, so you know what to expect. You might have seen it when you were 5 or 6, but obviously it's different to if you'd seen it if you were our age now. But I still think if we hadn't seen it before and we watched it now, seeing Mr. Big, you would think, oh, something's not quite right there. But you wouldn't think, oh, yeah, he's got a mask on his face.
Yeah.
I don't think. And then the reveal is really good. And the way that it's done, it takes him a couple of goes, pulls off a bit of the nose, pulls off the cheek, and then a little bit more, and then takes off the wig. I think it's done really, really well.
He's got like a really menacing stare, isn't he, that dude?
He has. Yeah. Really, really good. And Roger's like, ooh, quite revealing. And like, he's got his good comeback. I think that's a really good scene. And then it's, you've got the two, you've got the Kananga being quite sort of softly spoken, almost comic, in the way that he's sort of saying, sell heroin for money, what do you take me for, sort of thing, when he's sort of playing Bond. And then completely contrasting with that, you've got the question still stands by the gentleman concerned. And then, like, he can flick, can't he? Flick, sort of character and flick deposition. And it's really good. I think he's just like,
It's nice. It's one of those things, isn't it? I think that's a good way to get across somebody who's mental, like really insane, is like they're calm one minute and then like furious the next. And I think he gets that across really nicely. Yeah. So there's the whole scene where he's basically got Bond's watch and he tests solitaire. One of the things that always makes me laugh is when Mr. Big comes out and he goes, "Did you mess with that?" and points at that. That makes me laugh. But yeah, so there's the whole thing with the watch. And obviously she gets it wrong. Yet he still doesn't get Teehee to snap his finger. Do you know what I mean? It's weird.
Yeah. I think it was because he thought, well, he's going to do him at the farm. He's going to, like, not quite that way, but, you know, Bond will be sorted out at the farm. So it's like, why not do him here? But you can, there is a nice moment there where Teehee's got his claw around the finger. And as soon as he realises that he's not allowed to snip the finger, you can see a bit of disappointment on his face. Yeah. And I quite like that, because you obviously want him. And I know completely narratively wise it's screwed up, but imagine if he did cut off his little finger, Vesper would never have found out, would she, what he could have done with it.
It's a very good point. It's a very good point.
Narratively that doesn't count, but I think it's cool. And then I really like after Whisper comes in, doesn't he, in his big sort of red suit. I know I'm saying red a lot, but there isn't red. And then picks up Bond, take him to the farm. Now, the next bit, so Whisper carries him out, Teehee goes out, and then Baron Sarandi comes in. So you've got Sarandi, you've got Kananga, and you've got Solitaire. This bit is one of the most powerful bits in the whole film, like in terms of Kananga's anger and his, you know...
He's a bit... you could say he's a bit Kanangry.
Kanangry, Dr. Kanangry.
Thanks very much.
I like it. Very good. But he hits her hard, man. He hits her really hard. Mm. And it's not just like a thing. It's a full-on, he puts his whole sort of body into it. You know, he's not a happy chappy, that fella. No. One bit. But it makes for a powerful scene. And like, it's good.
It certainly does. Good. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, poor old Solitaire, though.
I think if there's anything you can do to make you dislike a villain, it's when they hit a woman. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like Largo did the same thing with Domino, didn't he? He was going to torture her and stuff. It just, you know, it does the job nicely.
What about when Bond hits women?
You kind of let him off, don't you?
No.
It's all right.
Who's your connection? Completely. Pretty bad. But then obviously, just before then Sandy comes in, doesn't he? And he gets the cards, if you can remember. Give them a little burn and then laughs and then they go away. So that's cool.
There you go.
So come to the next sequence now. This is probably one of my favourites in the film, I think.
This, again, is one of the most iconic Bond moments in the whole series. Everyone remembers this one. Like, it's just right up there. Trespassers will be eaten. The crocodile farm. Amazing.
Now, that sign was already there. That the farm, they found it when they were location scouting, and it happened to have that sign. And because of that sign, that intrigued them to go and check it out. And then when they saw what it was, they were like, oh my God, we've got to write this into the film sort of thing.
There it is.
That was already there. It wasn't like a production thing. It was like, that's the sign on the farm.
Awesome.
On the farm gate.
So so there we go. So basically Bond gets taken there and kind of given the tour. It kind of doubles as like a heroin lab, I suppose you would call it.
Yeah.
With all the crocodiles around it. So I guess that's a great way to keep snoopers out, isn't it? As you surround your heroin lab with crocodiles.
I wouldn't go in there.
Yeah. And then you just have that sequence where, you know, Teehee leads Bond out onto the little island off the wooden bridge. And he gives him the two ways to disable a crocodile.
Yeah. Now, if you were Bond, don't you think he walks off onto the island a little easily? I know, like, I know they're kind of talking and wistfully looking around, checking out old Albert, the croc, like, and a few others, and then he ends up on the island. Do you think that's a bit too naive of Bond to do that? Or do
there's
you think
no other way of saying it, but Bond can be a bit dense at times, can't he? Let's think back to From Russia with Love in the train carriage. Like, he's got Red Grant at gunpoint. Come and have a look at my map. All right, I'll get down on my I'll get down on my knees right next to you, and I'll have a little look at the map, and then bang, over the back of the head, done.
Yeah.
You know, and it's the same with this. You would have your wits about you a little bit more, wouldn't you?
Yeah, I think so. But what follows is freaking amazing, isn't it?
It is amazing.
What were the two ways to disarm a crocodile?
A pencil into the pressure hole behind his eye, or pull his teeth out.
I thought you were going to do it in Teehee's voice then.
Sorry, man.
But, no, that's all right.
I wasn't on the ball. But yeah, so there's those two. Obviously, he checks his pocket to see if he has a pencil, which he doesn't have. But like,
I like that. That's a really nice little subtle bit, isn't it?
Yeah. Cool. But, you know, this goes back to a time gone by. They would never do this stunt these days. I don't know whether it's like an animal cruelty thing these days, whether they'd be like, oh, you can't run across a crocodile. But, you know, now you'll get a computer-generated Komodo dragon. You won't get this happening.
Yeah.
And it's just such a beautiful moment. Like, I remember my Auntie Susan went to see this film at the cinema. She told me years ago.
Good old Auntie Susan.
Good old Auntie Susan. She went to see this film years ago, and she's not like a Bond fan at all. Like, you know, but she went to see it, and she said she remembers that scene where he runs across the crocodiles. Everybody started giving it a round of applause and like cheering. And for her, she said that she was like, oh, what are these idiots clapping for? It's just a film.
Yeah.
She's definitely of that kind of school of thought.
Yeah, okay.
But
interesting to note that the whole audience
went for it. Yeah, absolutely. But the great thing is you expect this stunt to be fake. You expect those crocodiles to be fake ones, because you could have easily faked it, couldn't you, really?
Yeah.
But it's done for real. And if you watch the making of, like, the first attempt, he almost didn't make it, just scrabbled onto the edge, and, like, the last crocodile actually got hold of his foot. But not, it didn't hurt him, thankfully. And then he got straight back up and just did it again. And the second take was the one, which is amazing.
I think he did five.
Was it five?
Yeah, I think he did five takes. And I think it was take three or four where the crocodile got him.
Oh, was it really? I apologise.
Yeah. No, but I mean, that's amazing though, isn't it? Like how many times he did it.
Mm.
And the dodgy thing is that Roger Moore, as an in-joke, wanted to wear crocodile shoes. Because he was like at the crocodile farm, he thought it would be quite funny. But the soles of the crocodile shoes were so smooth, they didn't have any grip. That added to the difficulty level when trying to leap across a crocodile's back. So he could have had something a lot more grippy and it might have been better, but that's why a lot of the times he'd like slip out.
Yeah.
Obviously the crocodiles move as well, but he'd slip out. But, I mean, just that bit where you see him, see the bridge going back, you see him with a couple of bits of chicken and all these alligators and crocs coming towards him.
Yeah.
And like, there's moments where they're, what, 2 or 3 feet away from him, if that. And you're like, for me, you know, Guy Hamilton in particular was fond of putting Bond in situations where you're thinking, how does he get out? Kind of like the burning coffin in Diamonds Are Forever. For me, I think this setup with the island and the croc is probably one of the best how do you think he'll get out of it scenarios.
Yeah.
Especially when you think, oh, there's a boat, uses his watch to, you know, get the oar holders. The rollocks to come towards him, and then obviously there we are, it's roped so he can't get it.
Yeah.
And then you're like, and then obviously what happens, but yeah, I think it's one of my favourite sort of situations, I guess.
It's good, like we were saying about the misdirection in this film before, that's another one of those, isn't it, where you think, oh, he's just going to use a gadget and get out of it, but then it's like a smoke and mirror thing, isn't it? It's like that's, and he just comes with something completely out of the box, which is great. I like it. So running across the crocs, that's great. And it should be mentioned that that stuntman was Ross Kananga, which is where the name Kananga came from. They named him after the stuntman.
What a brilliant name as well, though.
Fantastic, indeed. Completely. Yeah, completely. So there's that. And then basically, obviously, he tortures the place, sets all the, you know, lures all the crocodiles into the lab and all the lab technicians and stuff.
But do you think this was strange? Like, so he gets a big crocodile, scary as hell, that goes into the lab. Now, if you're on the side where the door is, I would shit myself.
Yeah.
But you've got about 10, 12 guys behind the glass and they see it and they leg it, even though they're behind the sort of glass thing.
Maybe, like, there was an open door. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe. No, maybe there was, yeah. Maybe the crocodile was like, could smell the heroin and was like,
completely, maybe.
Yeah.
Crocodiles and heroin, who would have guessed?
That's a good film title.
But then we have another iconic moment, and they're starting to rack up quite hefty in this film now.
Yeah. So there is a lot of them.
Indeed. So we've got the most amazing boat chase the world has ever seen, as it was... as I'm paraphrasing there, but it was written on the script. So you've got basically Bond jumping in the boat and scooting off down the bayou, and there's obviously the full-on chase. Now, I've heard some say that this boat chase goes on for too long. What do you think about that statement?
I agree it's long. I wouldn't say it's too long. I mean, if you're going to have the best boat chase in the world, you don't want it over after a couple of minutes, do you?
No.
Now, there is the aspect that a lot of it is unscored, like a large amount of it is unscored. I think obviously towards the end it gets a bit more scoring, but they do a lot in it. You think about it, so they've got the chase, they've got everyone going after him. They hit this sort of verge thing, you know. They go into someone's swimming pool, you know, Bond, I think Bond's engine gets hit, doesn't he? So he has to ditch his boat and then steal another while the bad guys sort of end up in a pool. So he goes off, then there's more come after him. And, you know, there's, and in between that, then obviously we're introduced to Sheriff J.W. Pepper, Louisiana State Police, and everything that goes around it. And you know, Adam, the sort of bad motherfucker. Who
the dude him, in the houndstooth jacket that's kind of, steals Billy Bob's boat,
That's it. So he we'd seen him at the airport, but, you know, he gets a bit more sort of screen time here. So you, so there is stuff going on outside of just the boat chase. But I mean, visually, it's amazing. You know, when they did that world record leap, it's like 110 foot over the road, and it's, you know, that is amazing. That is brilliant. And but he almost is impressive. If you know, he maybe even more perhaps is the timing they've got of when the cars are coming along the road and the boats are going up and over and down, and they missed them by, you know, that's something that you have to get just right. That you know. That's some scary stuff going on, what they're doing, and balls out as well.
There's a huge amount of skill involved in that boat chase, isn't there? I think with the people who say that the boat chase is too long, like, there's enough variety in there to keep it interesting. There's enough different stuff going on. Like you say, there's the bit where they go up and there's the baddies land in the pool, and then there's the part where the wedding's going on and one of them ends up hitting the tree, and then Bond's switching boats, and then you know, Billy Bob's boat gets stolen, and there's that whole angle of Billy Bob will get him there's that whole sort of comedy aspect. There's like, if you're going to have a long boat chase, you need to have to keep it interesting throughout and not just have boats going along, and some of those jumps, like you say, are timed to absolute perfection. It's incredible.
It's brilliant. And yeah, I mean, it's fantastic. But I do like the fact that Billy Bob's boat looks a beast and it sounds like a beast.
Yeah.
And like, you know, when that bit takes over, that's when I think the music starts to kick in, because you just see that boat overtaking the others. And then you know that they're getting to a sort of, it's just down to one guy now, isn't it? It's down to sort of Adam chasing Bond. And he's getting, and Bond knows he's going to catch him anytime soon. And then they end up in this sort of almost like a dock area, isn't it? But with hardly anyone around. Yeah. And then again, Bond uses his wits then, doesn't he?
That's the section that reminds me of Indiana Jones a little bit as well. That bit where it's all quiet and they're kind of sneaking around. It's like, I think it's Last Crusade, isn't it, where there's a boat chase like that?
Yes, it is. Yeah. When they're in Venice, that's it. And then they go towards the sort of fan of a big boat. But yeah, no, it does. You're right. It's very sort of similar to that setup, I think.
So obviously he dispatches him by throwing some petrol in his eyes, and then sort of like moving the boat along and guiding it into the back of the big ship that's parked up there, which leads to big a massive explosion which is kind of funny. I would have thought he would have just gone up the ramp and that would have been it, but they got off their own an explosion at the end of it, which is nice. But so that's the end of the boat chase. So we're kind of coming up to the climax of the film now, which is kind of back to San Monique and the kind of, you know, it's another voodoo kind of ceremony, like we see at the beginning with Baines. But this time, obviously, it's Solitaire. She's all kind of tied up on that frame.
Well, even before they get there, when they bring her out, there's a pretty good cleavage shot thrown in there.
Amazing. Cracking cleave. It's lovely. So it's kind of, we've kind of gone back to the beginning. It's interesting how you see those pre-title sequence deaths, with the exception of the United Nations ones, they kind of occur again in the film. That's what we've got going on here. And then, so Bond kind of shows up. He's kind of spying on the whole ceremony while Quarrel runs off and lays all the little mines throughout the poppy fields. And he watches the whole kind of thing. How do you feel about that? Do you think, because basically there's that point where Dan Byler comes out. He's got the snake and he's pretty much going to go and get Solitaire with it. Yeah. The snake's right up at Solitaire's face.
Yeah.
And then he stops. Do you think Bond should have acted before then or what?
This is it. I was trying to work out what it was. And I think it was because when they're on the boat with Felix and they're saying, like, the incendiaries are set to detonate in 30 minutes, which is like midnight. So that got me thinking, well, maybe the sacrifices have to be at midnight. Perhaps, I don't know, you know, it's just something that I thought of. And Bond is there, and he's got his gun ready, and obviously if it gets too close, he's going to do something about it. But I think he's waiting for the bombs to go off, so it'll cause a big distraction. So while everyone is distracted, then he can, like, do his stuff, take out Dambala, free Solitaire, and then go. And I think, because you kind of see he's kind of looking up as if he's almost listening out for something. So I think I think his intention is to wait until the bombs go off, but obviously he's got to act sooner because of what happened, sort of thing.
Yeah.
But the reason I think, I think so. But with Dambala, the reason why I think he doesn't, because obviously the snake's super close, and with Baines, it just went up and killed him, didn't it?
Yeah.
So I think the reason it might be different is possibly because he has to, because when he goes away, we then see the hat being brought out, put on the grave, in front of the gravestone, and then Baron Samedi rise up. And as soon as he closes his eyes, that's when Dambala is about to then kill Baines. So it's almost like he was waiting for the signal from Baron Samedi before he could kill Solitaire. And I think that's probably why he didn't kill him straight away. I know we didn't see Baron Samedi in the pre-titles, but perhaps that's why he waited this time.
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
That makes sense, but I suppose.
What do you think of the whole sort of robotic Baron Samedi? It's strange, isn't it?
It is a bit weird, isn't it? I don't quite know what to make of it, but it's kind of like, I suppose when it comes to Baron Samedi in this film, you've got to give it some poetic license because he clearly is a human, but when he gets shot, you know, those eyeballs are definitely human eyes that roll up. That's
brilliant. I love the way that they do that. The eyes, the head's been shot off, but the head is almost like it's made of, you know, what, porcelain or something.
Yeah.
But yet the eyes do go up. And it's weird, but I love it. I really do like it. I think it's cool.
And then obviously you've got the other Baron Samedi that comes out and ends up in the snakes, but then you've got Baron Samedi on the train as well. So I guess it's just one of those, like, funny kind of things that you got to get.
But because of that character and where he's from, you can allow that.
Completely.
But no, I like it. I mean, when he comes out, he shoots a sort of robotic one, and then the other one comes out. Now, the only thing is, I would have loved to have seen a little bit more here, like, because Baron Samedi's sort of, and then he picks up that sword, and then he goes to hit Bond. Bond basically does one block, one punch, and then, like, chucks him in the coffin.
Then it's game
over. And I think for someone that's like the Lord of the Dead, you know, for someone that's had such a massive impact on the film and everything, I would have liked to have seen a little bit more. Like, even if it was 20, 30 seconds more.
It is a shame, isn't it? It's kind of like you would have expected a more of a grand death for Baron Samedi.
Yeah.
Like, has Bond run out of ammo? Because basically Samedi comes up to him with a machete, Bond throws his gun away and grabs the nearest machete he can find. And takes him on hand to hand.
Does he throw his gun away? Because it is strange.
He either throws his gun away or he just kind of puts it away somewhere.
Or, you know, when he shoots Dambala, I think twice, and then he shoots another guy that comes up once or twice. I mean, he wouldn't have gotten rid of all his bullets. Does anyone ever knock it out of his hand?
I wrote down, like, why does he throw his gun away? So I think he just drops it on the floor and grabs a machete.
Maybe it has run out of bullets in that case. Maybe that's what we'll say.
But of course he's shot the robotic Samedi as well by that point. Yeah. So he's had his six by that point. I don't know. I guess using that gun as well is another step away from Connery, isn't it? Because that's like a proper massive Dirty Harry gun, isn't it?
Yeah. That's exactly a Dirty Harry gun. It's Magnum, isn't it?
It's funny, isn't it? Because it's like you would never have seen Connery using a weapon like that. No. So it's good that, again, they're stepping away from it.
In the apartment back on, you know, early on in the film when his gun was taken, and we think it was Whisper, then he obviously, when he's with Rosie, you know, when they're lying by the river, he's then got his Walther back. So did... Maybe Quarrel, when he was on the boat, had a spare Walther to give him. That's what, because I was wondering, how did he get his Walther back? So it's either Rosie took it and gave it back to him, but I think Whisper's the more likely version, in which case Quarrel must have had a spare one to give to him.
Yeah.
As to why he didn't take that onto the island and chose to go with the Magnum, I'm not sure. But I do think he looks pretty rock. Like Roger in his Black Commander outfit with a sort of shoulder holster, this big Magnum. I know the Magnum is like, it's a different sort of gun, but it's different. But he does look good, I think. Roger in his gear, you know, he doesn't often look like a hard sort of nut, but in this he looks all right.
He's got his roll neck sweater on, he's ready for action. He's got, it's like when Brosnan does a mission at the end, he'll put his overalls on, won't he? Do you know what I mean? He'll get his overalls on and he'll go and do his mission, whereas Roger's like, I'm gonna get my roll neck out, my black trousers and my shoulder holster, and I'm ready. It's nice.
It looks cool.
So after that section, we've got the climax underground in the underground HQ.
Just before we get to that bit, did you see on the headstone the Baron Samedi rose out of? Did you see what was written on the headstone?
No.
It said, in loving memory of James Brooks. I don't know who James Brooks is, but I just wondered if there was any...
That does strike me as the sort of thing somebody would do in tribute to somebody, doesn't it? Like, whether James Brooks was, like, I don't know, the assistant production manager or something like that.
Yeah,
do you know what I mean?
I reckon, maybe.
But we'll have to go. Let's throw that out to the listeners. If you know if you know who James Brooks is, let us know.
Yeah.
The
other thing that struck me as well, you know when they go to the voodoo thing and those people, they go like this... They basically do like a crazy old body sign, don't they? Which I guess just adds to the craziness.
Oh yeah, whenever somebody shows up, doesn't it? They always get on their knees and kind of do that. But the underground HQ is in proper classic Bond villain style. We've got a monorail. We've got a shark pool. You know, it doesn't get any more Bondian than that, does it?
Caves, underground, monorail, shark pool. I mean, that is classic Bond villain territory. And great as well. Everyone should have a monorail. I want a monorail. Like every Bond villain. Do you reckon maybe Spectre might... Is there going to be a monorail in Spectre?
I bloody well hope so, man. I hope so. Yeah. If there's going to be a big old school base in Spectre, they've got to have a monorail.
I
won't be happy if there isn't one, but so we've got kind of like, so some would say, like, okay, so let's take it step by step. You've got Bond and Solitaire kind of tied up on the unnecessarily slow moving dipping mechanism, and then obviously Kananga kind of like, you know, slices a bit of his arm to get the blood out for the sharks.
I do like the bit that Bond is proper, so, like, he is rock hard. When Kananga's basically cutting his arm, Bond doesn't even wince, does he?
It's because he's double R, isn't he?
Well, he is, yeah. He's
a double R bastard.
he is.
But there you go. So you've got Bond... and Solitaire kind of hanging over, being slowly dipped down into the sharks. The old watch comes out. And I think, this is the first time we've seen a Bondian watch used in action, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? Like, obviously, there's always been a watch, but, like, a real solid gadget
effect
that it does.
I think he had a Geiger counter watch in Thunderball, but, I mean, that wasn't really...
That's true, but not you know what I mean?
Not like a proper... No, exactly.
Like, in the Brosnan years, you've got the lasers and all that kind of stuff.
Well, we had Grant's... wire watch.
Of course,
but that's
we did.
That's obviously a villain's one.
Yeah.
But in terms of Bond watch, this one, and it's a good one as well. Isn't it?
It's a good one.
Saw the magnet and everything, which is awesome and does the job. What did you think of the whole shark gun idea?
That sort of comes out of nowhere, doesn't it? It's not. Yeah. It's not really referenced until this point. It's sort of like a bit. Oh, what's this for? And we haven't seen it before. It's never referenced. It's just a sort of like a brief setup for Kananga's death, I suppose, isn't it? Well,
but that gun is Bond's, because when they arrive on the island, Quarrel says to him, "Oh, you'll need this shotgun on the way back." So basically,
oh, do you know? I missed that then. I didn't realise that you mentioned it. Yeah.
Yeah. So basically, that was obviously to shoot any sharks that come near them when they try to get back to the boat. But when they found the wetsuit, obviously they found the gun. But if Kanang had never seen this gun before, because he hasn't, because he said, "Oh, what is this?" And Bond sort of says, "Sort of shotgun," and then he shoots the sofa, which is quite cool, and sort of pops out. But then he you kind of know he knows what it is when he takes a bullet and he's almost pretends to open it.
Yeah.
And Bond's like, you know, don't.
I think that struck me as a bit weird, because it's like, I don't know whether, because I don't think he does know. Like, why does
then
he try?
Why
and
would
open
he do
it?
It?
Why is he trying to open
why
it? Because
whether
he knows that it's gas or not, how does he know? Like, why would you open it? I don't know. But
I think it was almost like, and what would the effect of that be as well? Yeah. Okay, it's compressed air, but if that did open, what would that do? Because it's almost from the way Bond responds, it's almost as if the room would cave in or something. You
yeah,
know?
Yeah.
So it is a bit of a strange one, that, I thought.
Yeah. Well, so like basically Bond escapes, like the buzzsaw watch kind of cuts the rope,
yeah.
swings down, throws poor old Whisper in that little
Whisper, yeah.
container thing.
He's probably still there now, isn't he?
Indeed, yeah. And you've got the kind of the brief sort of little knife fight, which is like that knife stance that he's got where his yeah. arms go up yeah. in the air. Yeah. It's kind of cool, yeah. isn't it? I've never seen anything like that before.
Would you know, I remember when I was younger and I used to watch Live and Let Die on a VHS, which was recorded off the TV. And like with a lot of TV showings of Bond, they had certain things clipped. And one of those aspects in Live and Let Die was this knife fight. Now, there was a bit of a knife fight, but the bits that were missing were all this sort of snake stance and almost voodoo stance. And when I saw that for the first time, I was overjoyed. I was like, this is so cool.
Yeah.
Because it is like almost, you know, but it is like a snake or voodoo or something like that. And it's strange and it shows his background and his character and his fighting style. And I just, even though it's not a big thing, for me, I was like, wow, that is really cool.
Yeah.
It's well, like...
Seeing Bond
things you've never seen before.
So yeah, good. No, that's nice, isn't it? I like that. I didn't realise they'd cut that bit out of the VHS. But yeah. That was just the TV broadcast, was it?
Yeah,
that
they cut out. So, yeah
they've TV, butchered yeah. those over the years, haven't
yeah,
they?
Yeah, I know.
But there we go. So you've basically got that. They fall into the water. And then
yeah.
would you describe this as the greatest villain death of all time?
Well, obviously, yeah. Now, I think this one is going to divide a lot of people, isn't it? I mean,
yeah.
there's a couple of ways you can take it. You can say, well, it's absolutely ridiculous, it looks stupid, and what the hell were they doing? Or you could say, it was a bit of fun, it was interesting. We've seen the sofa sort of blow up, so we kind of know what's coming. And, okay, you've got to take it with a little bit of pinch of salt, just it's a bit of fun. Okay, it's a little bit OTT, but it's not too bad. And I think you're always going to get that divided opinion, aren't you?
Yeah.
As to what side of the fence do you think you'd sort of stand
I
on?
Think, again, you take it in the context of the time in which it came, it is a bit silly. I mean, yeah. let's face it. But it's kind of funny. It fits in with Roger's yeah. vibe. Yeah. It's just one of those sort of oddities,
well,
isn't it?
I don't think it's any worse. Well, not much worse than Goldfinger being sucked out of like a aeroplane window that's about...
Do you know what I saw a Mythbusters about that, and they were basically they tested to see, they basically pressurized a plane to see if you would get sucked out of a window,
yeah.
and you wouldn't. Basically, the only way you get sucked out of a plane is if the hole was way larger. So that wouldn't have actually happened the way it did in that. But yeah, I think it is perhaps a bit more ridiculous than that Goldfinger bit.
Yeah.
I mean, the effects of Goldfinger being sucked out the window do look silly. But, like, in terms of actually, you could believe that happening, whereas
that's
genuinely inflating like a dinghy and then rising up to the ceiling like a helium balloon and then exploding is a different level, really, I suppose. But yeah. But, yeah, you know, it is what it is. It was 1973, for crying out loud. So, you know,
right.
what can you say?
Well, I think it's all right. It's all right, you know.
Yeah.
We'll let it go. It's a bit of fun.
Yeah, and, we'll let it go. It was probably Roger's suggestion, wasn't it? He was probably, that was probably his idea.
Yeah.
But, and then we get to the very end of the film, which is in the tradition of you think it's all over, but the henchman comes back at the last minute.
Yeah. Which I like.
Which I like as well, yeah. We haven't seen that in a little while.
No, I know.
So we see Bond and Solitaire. Well, Bond's teaching Solitaire how to play gin rummy. But she
getting his ass kicked.
Yeah, and she beats him. Now, is that the only time we see Bond lose at cards? Until, obviously, we reach Casino Royale and he loses the first round. I think it is, isn't it?
Wait a minute. Is there one... I've got one that I can think of, but I can't. It's not in the back of my mind yet. That's a good question. I'll see if I can think of one. Yeah.
Interesting. So then we've got basically Teehee showing up. Bond's haven't. Go on.
License to Kill, when he's playing the blackjack, he loses initially, but I think he does it on purpose so then he can raise higher stakes once he does it properly. But I don't think it's not.
Oh, okay.
Anyway, all right. Sorry.
Good memory, good skills. So then obviously Teehee shows up, they have the little fight, which is somewhat reminiscent of the Red Grant fight, isn't it? In a way,
train,
it does sort of have that sort of feel about it.
Did you like the bit where he slices through the mail sack in the room? I thought that was quite cool.
That is kind nice.
Just
yeah.
know what's coming.
Well, because when they both get on the train at the beginning, when they say goodbye yeah. to Felix, you see those sacks being loaded on. Yeah. Like that kind
and
of
you
wheels.
Know
and, yeah, you know something's up. And then obviously the little hook comes out and out he comes.
Although I did wonder how he didn't electrocute himself when he sort of pressed his hook against the circuit. Do you think he would or not?
Yeah, it's kind of like jaws in his teeth, though, isn't it? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
it's
yeah,
like
exactly.
You leave those, you let those run.
Yeah. Oh,
do you
yeah,
know
of
what
course
I mean?
You do. Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, funny enough. Yeah, so basically, you have the little fight in the train car. Bond clips his wires and dispatches him in a very similar fashion to Red Grant as well, the old out the window trick.
Yeah. Yeah. I think Red Grant wasn't out the window, was he? Jaws was.
Jaws, am I thinking of Jaws? Has, of course, yeah, Jaws out the window.
Yeah, Red
Grant,
he strangles him, Jaws out the window. But for me, I think this is actually a really solid fight. I like the for a Roger fight, it's quite good. You know, Roger gets in on it. He's a bit menacing. The fact that claws there is good. I like his laugh.
I like it. I listened out for that this time. I was
Did
very
you?
Much amused
yeah.
here.
but also, it's cool that, you know, his sort of weapon is also assisting in his demise. Obviously, when Bond cuts it, it's caught and you know that. What I think is one of the best bits about the fight is the fact that you get to see his arm.
Yeah.
So for the first time in the film, he rips his suit and you see this mechanical arm, you see this what's underneath. And for all this time, you would have just thought, oh, he's just holding claw, isn't he? Obviously. But now you've seen this arm, you're like, oh, actually, fuck, he's got an actual... And I think that adds to it a lot.
Yeah, that's nice.
And it's really cool.
Yeah.
And then obviously, chucks him out. Chucks
there
him
it
the
is.
Window and just being disarming, darling.
Just being disarming, darling. And then and then we see Baron Samedi on the front of the train. And then we're back into that amazing theme song. And we're at game over. Roger's first Bond movie, done and dusted.
Done and dusted. What did you think of the Baron? I thought the Baron Samedi was inspired just having him.
It's nice, isn't it?
Laughing.
It's nice.
I think it's good.
Yeah.
It just adds that extra something, I think.
Yeah, it's good.
But it's cool.
Okay, then. So how do you feel about Roger's first Bond?
Well, I think it was a brilliant first Bond for Roger. I think it was really good sort of vehicle for him. The way... You know, his Bond straight away, he had his interpretation of Bond down. You and it worked. Like, there wasn't any, you didn't have to wait any time. You saw it was different, but you accepted it straight away. There wasn't any question of, oh no, this guy can't do anything.
Mm-hmm.
It was really good. I think the film itself, for me, it's really is one of the most memorable of the Bond films. We've mentioned throughout as we reviewed it, there's so many iconics. Maybe not iconic. Okay, there might be one or two iconic. But even if it's not iconic, there are memorable scenes. There are scenes that are, you know, if you think Bond or whatever, they will be in there somewhere. And I think this film has so many of them and so many plus points as well. Like the voodoo and the spiritual side bring something that we've never seen before and we probably won't see again. But it just adds that something extra, doesn't it? You know, the skulls, the scarecrows, the snakes, Baron Samedi, and all that sort of stuff. That side of things, I think, is amazing.
Yeah.
So, I love it, basically. I think it's a really, really solid first film for Roger.
Yeah, I'm total agreement with you there. I think it's a great one. I think there are definitely iconic moments in this one. I think the alligator... Yeah.
The alligator.
Alligator jumping is definitely iconic. Yeah. I think the boat chase is an iconic boat chase. Certainly,
the coffin death in the pre-titles.
The whole jazz funeral thing, everyone remembers that scene. You know, it's one after another, really, with this one. You know, great villain. Baron Samedi is really visually one of those things that people remember, one of those villains.
Yeah.
It's great. I love it. I think it's really good.
I think that's probably one of its major plus points is... The amount of villains, I know we mentioned in the Henchman sort of podcast before, but okay, so you've got Mr. Big, Dr. Kananga, that's almost two villains for one. You've got Teehee, who's brilliant, he's got a metal claw, he's big and he's quite a good character. You've got Baron Samedi, he's just this weird guy, but he's massive, he's tall, he's freaky, he's scary. You've got a Whisper, who's like a bit different as well, he's just a big guy, but he's got a funny voice, but he killed the guy with the dart gun.
Yeah.
You've got Dambala with the snakes. You've got the Switchblade Assassin by the jazz funeral. You've got Adam, who's like the bad guy driving the boats, you've got the taxi driver, you know, the list goes on and on. But it's great because there's so many obstacles for Bond along the way. Yeah. And they're not just 2D characters. You know, they've each got a quirkiness to them, which makes them rounded characters and makes you sort of enjoy it more.
Absolutely. I think it's a bang up job. It's interesting though, some of the reviews at the time weren't the most favourable. They were saying that Roger didn't stand up to Connery. It was just basically a big excuse to have a big boat chase and all that kind of stuff. But I don't think that's true at all. I think it's the perfect introduction to a new Bond.
Definitely. And there are two cracking things with this film. One, I think the soundtrack, including the theme song, is for me one of the best in the series. The theme song is, and the soundtrack. I mean, I'll always praise Majesty's and probably You Only Live Twice as maybe my two favourites, but I think this could possibly be top three. If not, it'd definitely be top five. The soundtrack, it's like you'll listen to a certain cue and you'll get that scene. And because the scenes are so memorable and because the music is so effective, they work off each other. So I think that really helps the film. The music's amazing. And I think in Solitaire, you've got perhaps not one of the, you know, perhaps cleverest sort of Bond. You know, she's not a Tracy Bond. She's not a pussy galore, but she is an absolute stunner. And she has a really intriguing backstory with the whole psychic stuff like that and the card reading and her mum and everything like that. I think it's great. So those two things, I think, are really strong aspects for the film. Conversely, perhaps the Rosie Carver character, Rosie Carver, isn't it? I was thinking Paris Carver. Rosie Carver. Her character could do with maybe it was a little bit weak in places, I think, for me.
Very much so. Yeah.
Which is a bit of a shame because for the majority of the scenes that are outside her little part of the story, I think the film is probably a bit better. What about Sheriff J.W. Pepper? What do you think of him?
I love him. I think he's like the comedy relief, isn't he? I think he's great. I think he's funny. I think some people would say he might be like the Jar Jar Binks of Live and Let Die. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I don't agree with that. I think he's great. I think he's brilliant.
Yeah. Did you know, right? I read recently that Eon, there was such a big response to his character in the film that Eon put an advert in a magazine trying to get votes to have him as an Academy Award nominee.
The best supporting actor.
Yeah, and you're like Clifton James, who's Sheriff J.W. Pepper, winning an Academy Award. It's just crazy. But no matter what you think of the character, he plays it well, doesn't he?
I mean,
he plays it really, really well. So that's there. And also, we mentioned it early in the film, but Bond lighter. I think the Bond lighter chemistry in this film is brilliant.
Yeah.
It's probably one of the best films that you see Felix Leiter in terms of, you know, he's in some good scenes sort of thing. And he's just really pally with Bond, isn't he?
Yeah.
And that's what you want. You don't want someone that's a bit offish or whatever.
Yeah.
So I think that was good for it as well. So there's a lot. We mentioned the whole sort of plot being quite, you know, potentially having a realistic side. I think that works in favour, in contrast to the voodoo and all the big events as well. There isn't a lot wrong with it, aside from perhaps maybe the Rosie Carver character, you know, and there are certain little silly things, but nothing to worry about. I think it's a cracking film. I think it's one of the most memorable Bonds. Brilliant for Roger. Amazing soundtrack. Amazing list of villains. Amazing looking, anyway, Bond girl. But also, she isn't dumb like Stacey Sutton. There is something else to her. I think, you know, if there's Bonds I haven't seen, like we always say, you kind of get a buzz when you want to watch it.
Yeah.
I'll never find myself not getting a buzz for Live and Let Die. I'll always, if I think to myself, oh, I haven't seen that one in a while, Live and Let Die is always one that I know I'm going to enjoy watching. It's always a fun Bond to watch, Live and Let Die. It's got a lot going for it.
Damn right. I love it.
That's my
good stuff. I suppose at the end, once we've reviewed every single film, we're going to have to do an episode, or maybe a double barrel episode, where we actually put these in order of our rateage, which is going to be the most difficult thing to do. Hard. Yeah, that's going to be tough.
Well, I know what your top one is, so that's all right.
Oh, there you go. I know what your top one is as well, so that's easy enough.
Die another day for you, so that's
There we go. All right, cool. So that's Roger's first movie put to bed. So you know what it's time for, don't you?
Go on, what is it?
It's time for Bond Facts.
Flames, explosion, fire, Bond Facts.
There it is. So what have you got for me?
So we got quite a few this week. So obviously we're on the Live and Let Die theme. So Bond Fact number one, Sean Connery turned down a whopping $5.5 million to play Bond in Live and Let Die.
Whoa.
Now, if we remember, only 2 years previously, when he did Diamonds Are Forever, he was paid, I think it was $1.2 million. Okay. Now, at the time, $1.2 million was a shed load, the most an actor had ever been paid. So we're only 2 years later, and he was offered, what, five times out of four and a half times out of whatever it is. $5.5 million is a huge amount, and he turned it down. So obviously he'd had enough.
Yeah.
There we are. Okay, Bond fact number two. A couple of interesting ones here. Regular Bond voice artist Nikki Vandersil dubbed much of Jane Seymour's dialogue. Now, this is strange, isn't it?
Yeah, it is strange.
We know she's dubbed a lot of the sort of, you know, the sort of foreign female actresses. But yeah, Jane Seymour, apparently she dubbed a fair bit of her work as well. But to not only dub if you're just doing a whole thing, but obviously Jane Seymour's dialogue was in the film. So to try and match someone, not just dub a character that you don't hear the actual actress speak, but to dub and to match someone that's already...
That's pretty incredible, isn't it?
That is some hardcore work going on there. So that's quite interesting. Now, this is the interesting thing as well about the taxi driver. He was dubbed.
No!
I know! I didn't really want to tell you because I didn't think you'd enjoy it. And when I found out, I was a bit upset.
I'm gutted.
I know, so am I, because the look is brilliant, isn't it? The big sideburns, the cheesy grin, and like the energy that he's got. And yeah, apparently he was dubbed, unfortunately.
Gutted.
Which is a shame. Yeah, I know. I thought so. Okay, so Bond fact number three. The characters of Baron Samedi and Dambala are named after two powerful lower spirits in voodoo religion.
Interesting.
Bond fact number four. CIA agent Rosie Carver's weapon was a custom 0.38 Smith & Wesson gun with a corrugated 3-inch stock and no serial number. In addition to the traditional Walther PPK that Bond uses, he also has a Smith & Wesson 44 Magnum in the film, which is, as we mentioned, the gun made popular by Dirty Harry. And funnily enough, Clint Eastwood was approached to play Bond at one point, but said, no, Bond has to be British and not American. So that's interesting there.
My name's Bond. James Bond, punk.
It might work.
It might have worked, yeah.
If you did it, I think. Bond fact number five. In Live and Let Die novel, the real name of Mr. Big was Bonaparte Ignace Gallia. Apparently.
Interesting.
In the film, the real name of Mr. Big was changed to Dr. Kananga after the stunt performer Ross Kananga, who owned the Crocodile Farm, performed the dangerous leap across the crocodiles, as we mentioned. Now, Ian Fleming's based the Bond girl Solitaire's name on the Jamaican solitaire bird, but her actual full name in the novel is Simone Latrell. But this is obviously never mentioned in the film.
Interesting.
Bond fact number six. This is the first Bond film in which 007 commits a political assassination, Kananga being a prime minister. Bond fact number seven, we mentioned that one, I beg your pardon. Bond fact number, we're going to skip seven. Bond fact number eight, screenwriter Tom Mankiewicz dabbled with tarot cards to familiarise himself with the art. He took them to a party once and performed tarot readings on the guests. At that party, Michael Caine and his then girlfriend attended, and he used his tarot cards to predict the two would be married. The two later married, and Mankiewicz said in his autobiography that for years afterwards, Michael's wife, Shakira Caine, was convinced he had special powers.
Well, how about that?
So there you go. Bond fact number nine, the literal translations to this film's title in different foreign languages include The Dead Slave, or It Is Them to Die in Japan, Live and Leave to Die, France, Allow to Leave Alone to Die, Poland, To Live and Let Die, Norway, With 007, You Live and Let Die, Brazil, Agent 007, Live and Let Die, Italy. So a few ones. And finally, Bond fact number 10, there are several scenes and lines in Mankiewicz's script which were actually dropped from the film. Now, these are some really interesting points here. So the most notable was the loss of an opening scene, which was going to be the actual pre-title scene in which we do see James Bond. So now this was going to be a scene with James Bond where he was going to have met an old man in a garden at night. Now the man was to have handed over a special pair of contact lenses, and now on these lenses were going to be a mission that Bond would put on and he would see, or some sort of secret information.
Oh, interesting.
But their meeting was due to be disturbed by the approach of enemy agents, and Bond tries to help the old man escape over the high garden wall that surrounds it. But Bond then discovers that the garden is in fact on top of a very high building, and the contact fell to his death miles away. And apparently they even had an actor signed up to do that role. An actor called Michael Sheard was cast, but obviously the scene was never filmed. But imagine that as a pre-title. So Bond's in this sort of garden, it's at night, he meets this guy, he gets these contact lenses to like for a mission or whatever. Hears someone quick get off, and then sees this guy fall to his death, and they're on top of the field. You think Bond would have known how he got there? So I don't know. It's a bit strange, but isn't that from You Only Live Twice? Something similar. Is
there, Blofeld has his Garden of Death in You Only Live Twice. Yeah. It's just full of poisonous plants and shit.
Yeah, that's right.
But I don't know. I feel like that would make Bond look a bit silly, wouldn't it? Do you know what I mean? Like helping him over the wall, and then the guy falls to his death. I think.
Yeah, I think they were right to lose it. Yeah. The only thing that I think could be taken out of that, I do like the idea of the contact lens with the information. I think that's quite a cool idea.
Yeah, that is a nice idea.
Three more little scenes here. So there was also going to be one scene, this might explain it, where Quarrel Jr. demonstrates a gas pellet gun, the shark gun, with Bond, will eventually use to kill Kananga while they were out shark fishing. So apparently there was going to be a scene with that. There is also a dialogue reference to Quarrel's father and his encounter with Bond, and apparently Bond at one point would say his father and I locked horns with a doctor named No several years ago. Now that probably, I don't know, would that have been too much info?
That would have been too much. I don't think you would have needed to say Dr. No. If he'd have said I knew his father once upon a time, that would have been enough. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it would have been too force-fed otherwise.
Yeah.
And finally, there was an additional scene in which Kananga threatens to cut off Teehee's arms and feed it to the crocodiles when he harms Solitaire, but that was also removed as well.
Interesting.
So, there are the Bond facts.
Plenty of Bond facts for Live and Let Die this week.
Quite a lot.
Yeah, there we go.
Hopefully not too many.
Yeah, and another interesting thing to remember, we both have a copy of this, is that during the filming, Roger kept a diary of the filming of Live and Let Die from beginning to end. And it was actually published as a book, which you can still, it's obviously out of print, but if you go on Amazon, you can get it secondhand and all that kind of stuff. It's really, really interesting. And it's kind of literally a diary of everything from like him arriving in New Orleans to start shooting and like exactly what it was like to be him during the filming of the movie, which is great. And it's known as Roger Moore as James Bond 007, Live and Let Die. That's the full title of the book. And the cover is that kind of shot of him, like he's in the black roll neck holding the gun. And I think there's a bullet hole
shattered
there,
glass. Or
yeah,
something, isn't
shattered glass.
A bit like the Spectre logo, actually.
Indeed.
Now, this book I definitely recommend to any Bond fans, especially those that like Live and Let Die. Like I read it a few years ago, and I think mentioned it to Tom, and we both read it, and it really is. It's not like any other Bond book. You've got an actual Bond actor telling you about their time, and you know Roger's really good with the humour and his storytelling, and I found a copy on eBay for, £3 or £4, which is nothing.
Yeah.
Obviously, you're not going to find a new copy because it was ages ago, but I really do recommend anyone out there to try and find it. It's Roger Moore as James Bond, 007, Live and Let Die, and it is a brilliant read. Fantastic.
The thing is, you know what? The thing I love about Roger more than anything else is he seems to be like the most down-to-earth, and he seems to, at the same time, you see him in interviews and he seems to be the one who appreciates Bond the most out of all the actors so far. Do you know what I mean? I remember seeing an interview, I think you posted it on Facebook the other week, which was from like the time of them shooting Moonraker. And he was just saying how lucky he felt and that he could be doing like a 8-hour shift on a dockyard or something. I can't remember exactly what he says, but he was just like, you could just tell he was loving every second of it and really appreciating the position he was in, which is great.
I think he was definitely the most press friendly Bond that there's ever been.
Yeah.
He loved it. And I think that has got to hold some stead with people that, you know, that gives you a special gives him a special place in my heart, and I'm sure it does you, because you've got to love people that love Bond, and you've got to love people that love playing Bond even more. And you know, I think Pierce actually has some of that. Pierce, I know it didn't end all that well, but Pierce has a lot of love for Bond.
Yeah.
He's forever saying it was amazing, it was the best sort of part of his career, and how much he loved it. And Pierce had a lot of love. And even while he was filming, he would do a lot of the interviews.
Yeah.
I think Roger would be the top. I think Pierce would be second. I think Danny and Sean are probably not too good. George obviously was a bit difficult. Tim was very solitary.
Yeah.
So it really was Roger and Pierce, but Roger in particular, the ones that really sort of, you know, you feel their passion for it, which is
absolutely. Do you know what? He did one of those on Facebook the other day, Roger Moore, like you can message through his website, and if he likes your question, he'll answer it on Facebook. And I saw it literally, I think it was the day before yesterday, it came up, and somebody asked him what the hardest decision he'd ever had to make was. And he said, sorry, I've got a little something in my throat.
Is that what he said?
No, he didn't. He said the hardest decision he ever had to make was leaving Bond, but he knew he had to because he was too long in the tooth, but it was the hardest thing he ever had to do.
That's a good answer, isn't it? That is a really good answer.
Yeah.
Oh, we love Roger. I love Roger. We all love Roger.
We all love Roger.
I just, like we said it before, imagine going out for a drink with Roger. How cool that would be.
It would be amazing, come on, Roger, wouldn't it?
We're hitting the town. We'll get some nice brandy on the go as well. And it would just be like a night to remember. He'd just keep you entertained all night. And he is like your cool uncle or something.
Yeah,
That you just want to go and listen to and stuff.
Well, there you go, Roger. If you're listening, send us an email and we'll come and hang out.
Yeah,
there we go. So it's time to answer our Bond trivia from the beginning of today's episode. So
do we have a Bond trivia thing?
You made one up recently, didn't you? How'd it go? I remember you just going, "It's Bond trivia," or something along those lines.
Oh, I can't remember. All right.
There we go.
We'll get one.
So as I went first, I will pose my question again. And my question was,
yes,
what did Bond and Baines have in common?
Now, we said it definitely wasn't an espresso maker.
Mm-hmm.
So, I believe they shared the same bootmaker.
They did. I'd rather like Baines. We shared the same bootmaker. There it is.
I wonder what bootmaker it was. Who's Bond's brand of boot?
I don't know. I've never heard him really referencing boots before.
No, perhaps we should look into it.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, cool. Good question. Very nice. Okay, so my trivia question of the day was, when Bond meets Felix after doing his little boating tour around the place on the docks, what three cards does Felix show Bond?
Is it Fortune, High Priestess, Death?
You got a fantastic 2 out of 3.
Ah, okay, go on in. What is it?
Death and High Priestess are definitely there.
Yeah.
But Fortune is alluded to on actually the poster, funnily enough. You don't see it in the film, but you know the poster of the girl with the card behind her? You do see Fortune on that. The other card was the moon.
I wouldn't have got that.
And those are the three ones that Samrady had that they picked up.
There we go.
But yeah, no, cool though. Got High Priestess and Death, which are, to be honest, they're the main ones.
Thanks, man. That makes me feel better about myself. All right, cool. So let's hear the greatest jingle of all time.
Bond, 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 Bond. James Bond.
There it is. It's the guess the quote round. So I believe it was your quote last week, wasn't it?
It was indeed, yes. Yeah. So my quote, I'll say that again, is, "Boss, you're alive. So glad to see you."
Now, I heard that as Lieutenant Hip. Like
that's because of the U. I'm trying to change the U. It's the U that's throwing me. The U, it comes out too hip-like. Shall I try and do it again?
Go on. Try
not to concentrate on the U. Okay. "Boss, you're alive. So glad to see you." Ah, the U is so difficult. Sorry.
It's tricky. I'm struggling with this.
It's someone who works for someone. So, obviously. If I said to you, the person that's saying it, you think he's good, but then he turns bad. And the person he's working for is a very good friend of Bond. And he's got a walking cane. that turns into a gun. And the other guy might have... No, the guy who he works for has. But the guy who says a quote might potentially have a dental thing going on. And it's not Jaws.
Oh, it's Bullion, isn't it? Mr. Bullion.
Yeah.
Yes.
Nice one. Yeah,
I needed about 500 clues to get that one.
No, that's all right. That's
That's it, isn't
like, it? Boss, you're alive. So glad to see you.
That's it. Like well that. Done. That was a good one.
No, but my U's are too hip-like. So
You sounded Asian then. So glad to see you. Yeah. But it's all right. All right. It was good. Okay, so cool. I think you might get my quote of the week reasonably easily.
All right.
I just got to prepare myself for this one because there's a certain level of performance that I have to bring with this.
Do I have to sit back? It's not a Felix Leiter. Go to hell or whatever it was. See you in hell.
It might be, so prepare yourself.
Okay, okay. I'll go.
Abba-bomb!
That's brilliant. That's brilliant.
Thank you. I'm going to wreck it out again just for those who didn't hear that the first time. Abba-bomb! So I think you've probably got that straight away, but I thought I'd wreck it out anyway.
No, that is brilliant, though. That is brilliant. Yeah, no, I like that. That's good. That's really good.
Cool. Okay, so our quotes will be revealed in the next episode. So make sure you tune in for that. So we had a listener quote last time from Mr. Dave Rolfe. So we're going to play that for you again now, and then we'll answer it. So here it is.
You were saying something about the lost art of interrogation?
Okay, so did you get that one, Chris?
I did actually get this one reasonably easily, but I thought the delivery was great. And it was a really good quote, that one.
Let's hear it then.
I think it was, I knew it was from Goldeneye, and then after listening to it, I think it was Dmitry Mishkin.
That's what I had as well. So let us know, Dave, whether we've got that right or wrong. I can hear him saying it, though, sitting in that little interrogation room.
Yeah.
And there it is. So good stuff. Yeah. I kind of heard it as a room off when he first said it.
Yeah, and so I wasn't sure. I knew it was one of those two. Is that because he comes into the room just afterwards, doesn't he?
That's right. So I'm fairly certain that it's Dmitry Mishkin, Defence Minister. So there we go. Okay, so we have a new listener quote this week from Mr. Jeff Silence, who we've seen on Facebook quite a lot. So good on you, Jeff, for piping up with a quote. So let's have a listen to that.
Hey, guys. Jeff Silence here. I'm actually on vacation, and I'm near one of the locations for a Bond film and thought this might be a good time for a Bond quote. Unfortunately, I'm not on the actual location itself. If I were, there'd be too much background noise and you wouldn't be able to understand me. But, here goes. And I'm Dick Tracy, and you're still under arrest. Good luck to you guys. Can't wait to listen to the quiz. I have about an 8-hour drive ahead of me, and got something to entertain me on the way down. Love the show. Bye.
Okay, so there it is. I've got that one. I'm fairly certain I have anyway. How do you feel?
Yeah, I think the line is quite a memorable one, isn't it?
It is.
As to the character, it would be an interesting one. But the actual line itself, I think, is, you know, it's a good quote. I think it's a good quote.
There we go. Yeah. Cool stuff. Okay, so moving on, just to round out the episode with some more kind of quizzage and stuff, is our guest music cue round. So,
I really like that. That's good.
Thanks, man. So, so last episode we had this one. Okay, so that one, I instantly knew what film it was from, but I wasn't 100% on which scene.
Would you have an idea?
Would say it's probably one of several, actually, it could be, and I don't know off the top of my head. I would say it was either... It's basically from New York in Live and Let Die, whether it's the occult shop, whether it's Bond tailing them in the taxi.
Ah, there we go. That's it. It's a point where, in fact, well done to all of our JBR listeners who got this, because I know there's quite a few that got this question, got the music cue right. It's actually the part where Whisper pulls alongside in the Pimpmobile, fires a dart, And it's the soundtrack that's playing while that's going on.
Very nice.
So yeah, really well done. You obviously twigged it, and you could tell that George Martin sound, couldn't you?
It's definitely just that wow, 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 like funky porno music. I love it. It's brilliant.
Funky porn is awesome.
Yeah.
So that was last podcast guest music cue, and we have a new one for this podcast. So here is the guest music cue for podcast number 30. Here we go. So, Tom, what do you think about that one? Any ideas?
I think the majority of our listeners will get that one pretty easily.
Yeah, we haven't had a music cue, I don't think, from this particular film. So yeah. I thought, well, you know, let's throw it out there. But it's a good one. It's a memorable one.
Yeah, I'd definitely. Say. Yeah, I like it. Yeah, it's
so
nice.
Yeah, anyone who's got any ideas of what they think it might be, then send us a message on Facebook or. And then we'll let you know if you're right or not. But cool. I think you probably will be.
Yeah.
So actually, this particular podcast, we've now got a new section, another new section. They're getting bigger all the same. Now, I'm actually throwing this out there. Tom, you weren't actually aware this was going to be part of the podcast. So this is a new one. What we're going to do, this is going to be called Complete the Lyrics Section. Now, in our Christmas bumper bonanza extravaganza quiz, We had a section where it was to do with the music, and there were one or two little things where we said a line of a piece of song, and then we had to, each other had to guess sort of the end of that lyric from the song. So I thought, well, wicked, why not stick it in the podcast?
I believe mine was, maybe I'm an open book.
Which I did get. Also, that has really got me. So you're good with these. So will you give us an opening section for Complete the Lyrics Section or something along those lines?
What, a theme tune?
Yeah.
Oh my God, you've put me on the spot now, dude. All right, let's try. Complete the lyric section.
Amazing.
That'll be a placeholder.
So good. That is a placeholder, definitely. Okay, so this is going to be the very first Complete the Lyric Section. And this is hopefully not too bad one. So Tom, he's not going to answer it now. We're going to leave it play like we do with the other rounds, and then we're going to tell you in the next podcast what it is. So this one is, set your hopes up way too high.
That was
cool. And I was trying to sing that out of tune purposefully.
Well, you did it very well.
No. I don't want to make it too easy. All right.
What you did is you sang that to the theme of For Your Eyes Only, which is really impressive.
I don't know how I did that or why I did that, but that's what I did.
That's nice. I like
it. Okay, so set your hopes up way too high.
Very
that
nice.
That is the line for this thing. So again, any ideas, send us a message on Facebook. Try not to put it on the Facebook wall, otherwise everyone will see it. So if you send us a message, then we can let you know then if it's correct or not.
Lovely. Good stuff.
There we are. That's it.
So that about rounds out episode 30. It's a bit of an anniversary for us today. 30 episodes in the bag.
I know. 30's not bad at all, is it?
No,
really,
not bad at all.
I mean, yeah.
So we're approaching our one-year anniversary birthday, aren't we?
We are. I mean, when was it? It was February 7th or
something? The 007th of February is when we launched.
February. So, I mean, that's not far away. We're going to have to do something special, aren't we?
Yeah, I think the Naked podcast might be the way to go. As a celebration, what do you think?
Can we have the funky porn music on in the background as we do it?
Definitely. Yes, I like it.
I'm liking it. The trouble is, we just won't get any watches on YouTube.
That's true. Yeah, everyone will be just downloading the audio rather than watching the video. That's true.
Good way to boost the download numbers, though.
That's true. That's a good point, yeah. So, maybe we should make that a regular thing.
Yeah, I like it.
But there we go. So thank you for listening to episode 30. Now, next up, I think, as I sort of revealed it a little bit today, or a couple of days ago on Facebook anyway, our next episode is going to be an interview with Shoot to Kill author Steve Cole, the new young Bond book. So we're going to be...
And a review of the book itself as well.
And a review of the book itself as well. So we're going to be chatting to Steve and we're going to be looking at the actual book itself. So if you don't have a copy yet, make sure you buy it. It's a super easy read. It's really, really good. You'll kind of speed through it in probably two or three sessions. It's a really, really good read.
Nope.
So make sure you grab a copy of that and we'll be chatting to Steve next time.
Yeah, look forward to it. I only got my copy today, and it's got a nice cover. I like it. So,
it's good. I've got mine here.
Look at that.
There it is.
Nice and shiny.
I'm about halfway through, so I'm 50% of the way there. But I'll play catch up. But yeah, so next time it will be Shoot to Kill with Steve Cole. So until then, I've been Tom Sears.
I've been Chris Wright.
And James Bond Radio will return with our interview with Steve Cole and our review of Shoot to Kill. See you soon. Take care.
See you next time.
Bye.
Bye. I knew you were going to do that. Bye. Wait, I can't not say it. Even then, I was thinking, right, should I say it? Oh, let's just say it. Bye.